Good morning, ladies and gentlemen. Welcome to today's Chicago Board of Education meeting. Today is May 25th, 2015. We are holding today's meeting in the boardroom at 42 West Madison Street. I am Frank Clark, and on behalf of my fellow board members, I want to thank you all for coming today. Today's meeting and segments will be Honor and Excellence, our CEO report, our public participation. We will then go into executive session, after which we'll come out and begin voting. I want to remind everyone, as I always do, that I appreciate the courtesy and respect you show one another at these meetings, and of course, I encourage you to continue doing that. Madam Secretary, will you please lead us in the pledge?
Thank you, Mr. President. Please rise.
I pledge allegiance to the flag of the United States of America and to the republic for which it stands, one nation, under God, indivisible, with liberty and justice for all.
Our board meeting is now called to order. Madam Secretary, will you please do the roll call?
Thank you. Can you kindly strike the gavel?
Thank you for reminding me.
Thank you, Mr. President. Member Furlong.
Yes.
Member Jordan Turner.
Yes.
Vice President Guzman.
Yes.
Member Dr. Hines.
Yes.
Member Father Garanzini.
Yes.
And President Clark.
Yes.
Six members present. There is a quorum, and I would also like to recognize Forrest Claypool, our Chief Executive Officer, Ronald Marmer, our General Counsel, Dr. Janice Jackson, our Chief Education Officer, Annette Gurley, our Chief of Teaching and Learning Officer, Cynthia Rodriguez, our Honorary Student Board Member, and Denali Quitos, our Shadow Student this month. Thank you.
Thank you very much. Cynthia, I know that you want to introduce our new Shadow Student, and then I have something to say about you.
Thank you, President Clark. Today we're joined by Denali Quitos, a junior at Roosevelt High School. Denali is the president of the Student Advisory Council and Book Club. She is also the Academic Decathlon Captain and National Honor Society fundraising leader.
Hello, I'd like to thank the board for offering me this opportunity, and I'm very honored to participate in this meeting, so thank you.
Those of you that may not know this, today is Cynthia's last board meeting. Cynthia has been with us for most of my term as president. I found her to be highly intelligent, well-prepared, and candid, and speaks on the behalf of fellow students. Mm-hmm. I also know that she's receiving two scholarships for academic achievement that, if I understood correctly, are giving you a full ride for your college, and I'll give you a chance to speak to that in a moment. You have been, in many ways, an inspiration to myself and other board members because you represent the future. You represent everything that mm-hmm. we believe we're trying to do here for students, and you have done, in my judgment, an outstanding job. I also know your principal is here, and I believe your father is here. Could you stand, please?
That's nice.
And Dr. Powers, I know that you're very, very proud of Cynthia as a part of Jones College Prep. Since I don't normally do this, but my instincts tell me it's a good idea, if your father would like to come up to the mic and speak for a moment, he can.
No pressure.
First of all, I'd like to say thank you to the board for giving this opportunity to my daughter, Cynthia. Thank you to Dr. Powers for running a very awesome school, Jones College Prep. And thank you to all here. Thank you to the students who are taking their time to be here with all of us. And for all the students, you guys are the future. Like Mr. Clark said, prepare yourself for the future. And like I've always told Cynthia, and whatever you do, just do your best at it. So thank you all.
Thank you. Thank you. She's obviously heard you. Cynthia, I'm going to ask you to speak in a moment, but to show our appreciation, I believe Susan has a gift for you.
Thank you to all. Thank you, President Clark. I'd like to thank the board, CPS leadership, and CEO for this amazing and eye-opening experience. It feels like just yesterday I was being given a tour of the boardroom by Estella. And so initially coming onto the board and taking on this position, I thought I was going to be some sort of magical CPS fairy that would fix all of the issues pertaining to student life and experience. However, I couldn't quite master all of the charms and spells. I have contributed and served as a communication bridge between both the students and the board. And again, I emphasize how eye-opening and enriching this experience was, because I realize now that solutions to complex issues are more than just fancy signatures and impassioned arguments. Change requires unity, strategy, and above all, communication. As I depart, I do so with the intention of coming back to the board and being seated somewhere along this desk. President Clark, perhaps your seat. Education is a
passion. I would say welcome to it, but people wouldn't understand what I meant.
Education is a passion of mine. I love school and I love learning. Drawing from my own experiences in CPS, I shall pursue a career in educational policy at Davidson College with the intent of providing all families and communities with the same cultivating and positive experience that I had. And once again, thank you to the board, leadership, and CPS leadership and CEO for a great time here on the board. And thank you to my principal, Dr. Powers, for his support, and my parents and my dad. Gracias por su apoyo. I really appreciate it. Thank you.
Thank you, Cynthia. I'm still a little bit out of order. If any other board member wanted to make a comment with respect to Cynthia, please feel free.
I'd like to make a comment. As the most junior board member, Cynthia outranks me in terms of tenure. I've gotten a chance to get to know her as a fellow board member, but also as a fellow Pilsen resident. So as a neighbor, as a point of pride for our community, I just want to congratulate you on what you're doing next year. Congratulations on your scholarship, and thanks so much for all your contributions that you've made this year.
Thank you.
Thank you very much. We will now proceed with honor and excellence. Dr. Jackson.
Good morning, President Clark. As you know, we begin every board meeting by honoring the remarkable accomplishments of our students and school community. At this time, I'd like to bring the chess team from Earl STEM Academy, located in Inglewood, to the podium. Many of you may have heard that our all-girls team won a national chess tournament that was hosted here in Chicago. First, to speak of the remarkable feat of winning a national competition, these students have practiced at length under the direction of Coach O'Cole, who I had an opportunity of meeting years ago when we worked on the West Side, and Principal Pettis. They not only represented Chicago, but they not only represented their school, they represented Chicago. And in addition to being invited here, they've actually been invited to be recognized at the White House, and we're going to work to make that travel possible. So at this time, I'd like to turn it over. If there's a representative from the chess team that would like to speak on behalf of the team, we'll take those comments. We'll also offer an opportunity for the coach and the principal to speak. And Mrs. O'Banner, who is a signed up speaker for today, would like an opportunity to speak out of order so that she can travel back to the school with the team. All right.
Good morning, board members, guests, and staff. My name is Jalita Willow. I'm an eighth grader at Earl STEM Academy. Chess has not only helped me to be a great thinker, it has also helped me in my everyday life, because instead of me being reactive to everything, it has taught me to think before I react. And people see us like, oh, they're African American, they can't play chess, but we didn't let that stop us. Every tournament we had, we gave it our best, and we proved them wrong by coming in first place at the All Girls Nationals. Chess is not only a game, it's chess like life. every move that you make, there's a consequence. Mm-hmm. And I'm very proud of myself and my team because winning first place in this game is not easy. And chess has also made me build my confidence up because I feel like if I can play this game and actually win, then I could do anything in life. Yeah. And it has taught me to be a leader and that it is okay to lose. And I think this program should be in all schools because it could give kids the opportunities that we had. And this is a big accomplishment for me, and I will carry this on with me forever. And every chance that I get to tell my story, I do. And last but not least, I want to thank my coach, Mr. Okul, because every loss that I had, he always told me it's not about losing. It's about whether you did your best in the game. And I think chess can really change a person because some of the kids in our eighth grade class was even saying how chess was lame, maybe even laughed a few times, maybe here and there. But now they play chess every chance that they get. I will be attending Morgan Park High School, maybe transfer to Whitney Young, and I hope to continue the great things that I did here at Earl.
Great.
Good morning, members of the board. My name is Tamaya Fultz. I am in the sixth grade, and I attend Earl STEM Academy located in the West Englewood community. The high school and college I want to attend is Whitney Young and ITT. Chess has changed my life by giving me the opportunity to travel across the United States and compete against people of different nationalities. Chess has improved my grades by increasing B's into A's and also improving my end of EA score by helping me reflect more and think more critically. And for that opportunity, I would like to thank my mom, Andrea Smith, my grandfather, Columbus Tainsley, my coach, Mr. Okul, my principal, Mr. Pettis, and the assistant principal, Ms. Butler, and last of all, my teammates. Thank you.
Okay. Mr. Claypool, Ms. Gurley, Dr. Jackson, and Ms. Little, and CPS administrators and guests, good morning. I am Joseph Okul, chess coach and math teacher at Englewood Elementary School. In behalf of the members of the team, in behalf of my students, I'd like to thank you for all the support you have given us. About 10 years ago, one of my students was shot dead. So that's the reason why I decided to be an instrument after school, and whatever resources we have, I tried my best to be an instrument, trying to save lives. It's not just about the game. Chess is not about the game. It's about saving lives, and that's how I decided to dedicate part of my time after school. There are values in chess, and I know that those who have played chess agree with me that there are values that can be shared in life, such as every move has a consequence. In life, there are mistakes, and mistakes are part of life, and learning, losing, and that's part of life. You learn from losing, you learn from your mistakes, and that's what I've always shared with my students. And in defeat, you need to be gracious. In victory, you need to be magnanimous. And what the world needs now are thinkers. And I want my students to be thinkers and to make this world a better place to live. Thank you.
Good
morning to all of the board members. My name is Barbara Whitlow. I'm the grandparent of Jelena Whitlow, and I came today and I count it as an honor to be a part of Earl Stem School with Mr. Okoo, Ms. O'Bannon, and Mr. Pettis being the principal, and how they have really supported the school and especially supported the chess team. And me being a parent or a grandparent to give the little support that I have. And what I have learned from following the young people and especially my granddaughter, making sure she's where she's supposed to be at the time. But I've really seen the difference that is made in her character and in her life. She's a young growing teenager, but chess has really helped her to start focusing on the things she needs to focus on as far as her grades are concerned. It really helped her. She was really kind of bad in math, but when she started playing chess, she went from maybe being a C in math, now she's an A in the algebra student. So what I'm saying as a parent that, you know, and I said this before, we focus a lot on the physical games that we have in our schools, like basketball, football, and all of those things. But I look at chess as being a mental game. And many times we don't think about the mind, but we have to think that the mind controls the body. So if you have a good, clear mind and have good, clear thoughts, then you're going to produce the type of children you will want to have, and they will be the adults you want them to grow. So I'm here to really strongly endorse, you know, the chess team, to say to you all, to help us to make our children better thinkers and pull the potential out of them that they have, and sometimes they don't even know they have and recognize, and help them to give the best that they can give to be the productive adults that we want them to do, be logic thinkers and to move forward in life. So please help us to continue with what we're doing. Thank you.
Thank you. Well said. Well said.
Good morning.
Morning.
Thank you for letting me be out of order. I just want to say thank you. I came down to support the students, our scholars at Earl. I want to give a special thank to Mr. John Scott for bringing Ms. Gail Ward out. We had the opportunity to have office hours at Earl back in March. And this is the accomplishment that we have done. And I want to give a special thanks to Ms. Denise Little for helping us. Because in 2014, I was down here crying in the tears, but I'm just as happy as I can be.
Oh, great.
And I just want to say thank you for the support that you all gave to our community. And thank you, Mr. Claypool. I had a great time with you at the rally at Douglas Park last week, and I'm supporting CPS tomorrow. And I just want to say just thank you for supporting our community, and I'm not going to cry. Thank you.
Thank you.
Good morning, members of the board. It is indeed a pleasure to be before you, to have my students, staff members, community members, parents here. To show the great work that is taking place at Earl is just phenomenal. Additionally, to see all our wonderful supporters before us. And just to let you guys know that your investment in Earl STEM Academy and all the Chicago Public School is definitely not in vain, but it is a tremendous investment that will pay huge dividends. I made a testimony to the Illinois State Board of Education, and we talked about requesting funds. And it was $15 million for our Children Home and Aid after school program. And my point to them is that it is indeed an investment that will definitely yield a return. And I stated a threefold return, $45 million, in terms of the investment in future employees who will be able to commit not only to the welfare of the United States, but I say to the entire world. Mm-hmm. So we ask that you continue to support us, and we will continue to go out before the nation and show that it is definitely a worthwhile investment. Thank you very much.
Thank you. Thank you. All well said. I don't want to reiterate all the points that you made. I think you guys did a really good job representing your school. The one thing that I would be remiss if I didn't say is just to really give Mr. Okoo the accolades that he deserves. First of all, success begets success. You were successful at Marshall. You took that over to Earl, and you guys are a better school as a result of that. But I also want to acknowledge the fact that you are the type of teacher that we need here in our district, that you go above and beyond. I know how long the hours that you work in order to not only do a good job teaching during the day, but to teach your students these lifelong skills outside of the regular school day. So on behalf of the district, I just want to thank you for your commitment and your dedication and your skill. Let's give one more big round of applause for the Earl all-girl chess team. Thank you. Go that way. All right. We have one additional item to showcase today. We would like to acknowledge a group of talented students from Amundsen High School who worked to create a very powerful video as part of the district's fight for equal funding. I remember when we first received that video, we spread it around, you know, through email, through the senior leadership team. CEO Claypool was especially impressed with the message. And because of that, the video has also helped us push our 20 for 20 message. So I'd like to introduce the students who put this video together, and we're also going to take a few minutes and observe the video. So girls, if you want to maybe just quickly introduce yourselves and introduce the video.
Hi, I'm Jesse Rojo. I'm a senior at Amundsen High School.
I'm Aliana Parajado, and I'm also a senior at Amundsen High School.
Hi, and I'm Karina Rivera, and I'm a junior at Amundsen High School.
Hi, I'm Lorelei Macbeth. I'm one of the art teachers at Amundsen.
Why me?
Why me?
Why me?
Why me?
Why me?
So far in 2016, Springfield has cut $500 million from the CPS budget, which means teachers' jobs are at stake. Class sizes will continue to rise, and academic electives and extracurricular activities will disappear.
Even with 20, 25 students, sometimes there's so many questions, you don't get through the entire lesson. I could only imagine 40 people.
By saying we will lose 20 teachers, that's terrifying.
Students are being robbed of their opportunity to fulfill their potential. Don't they deserve the same chance to succeed as the rest of the students in Illinois? Why is this happening to Chicago public school students?
Most of us are students of color.
Most of us are low income. Are we really equal?
Here's what's happening. While state funding has allotted $1 per student for all other districts in Illinois, CPS state funding awards CPS students only 74 cents. Chicagoans provide 20% of the state's education revenue, and despite making up 20% of the state's students, Chicago public schools are funded at only 15%. This doesn't add up. The missing 5% could mean more than $500 million in additional funding this fiscal year alone. Our schools are being denied the funds they need.
The fact that my education is being seen as less devalues me as a human being.
For years, Chicago public schools were written off and considered a lost cause. But on the contrary, attendance and graduation rates have risen. Students are performing better on standardized tests, and more students than ever are enrolling in college.
We had the potential to become great doctors, to become great lawyers, to become activists.
We need this for our futures, you know?
Illinois needs a long-term solution. Chicago needs a long-term solution. We need everyone to fight for equal funding for our children. Visit cps.edu/equality to send a message and take action. And visit sos-cps.com to reach out to your alderman, state representative, and governor.
Good job.
We thank you for your creativity and using your voice to help spread the 2020 message. Board members, does anybody have a comment?
That was a great video. They're always looking for newer and better and stronger lobbyists in Springfield. Seems like they could take a couple of you with them. Excellent job.
Thank you. I just wanted to add that I thought when I first saw it, it was remarkably creative. And so we did, as Janice said, passed it all over the place. And everyone was thought the creativity involved and the effort was extraordinary. And, you know, it did have a sort of a semi-viral effect on the web for a while. You guys should really be commended for that and for not just for your creativity, but your involvement in an important issue that affects you, but also our city and our schools and our communities.
One person didn't get to. Are you a parent or a teacher? Staff member. Okay, good. We just wanted to acknowledge everybody that contributed. All right.
Would anyone like to speak for the group and say anything about the process or what you did and how this happened? Just briefly. What was the genesis? How did it happen?
So in November, our principal, Anna Pavichevich, gave us a real reality check of, you know, this is what this is going to look like. And so a group of teachers, we thought, we really need to take action because the public isn't going to understand with all these charts and graphs and numbers what it's really going to look like. Mm-hmm. And so we thought we need to take action to motivate others to do that. So it started with a small group of teachers, and we started visualizing, like, you know, this group of teachers, some missing. Then we invited students to start to visualize what would this look like. And so we had it drawn out, and then thank you to Luma, came in and did their magic with, you know, cameras and sound and editing to bring it to this viral. And so I'm hoping if I can reach out. I mean, it's on Vimeo, it's on YouTube, but I'm not sure if it could be put at some point onto the CPS platform, you know, on the equality. I mean, the website's there. It'd be nice if it was on the equality site. So I don't know if that's something we could that could happen.
It'll be there.
Good. Yay. Thank you so much.
Thank you.
Yeah, thanks.
All right. President Clark, that concludes honoring excellence.
Okay, then we can. Thank you very much. We will now proceed with the business portion, and we'll start with our CEO report.
Thank you, President Clark. I want to start today by talking about lead testing that's happening in our schools. As you may have heard, CPS recently announced we'll be testing water in all the schools for traces of lead. It's important to understand this testing is out of an abundance of caution and not because we have a reason to be concerned about the quality of water in our schools. We began this testing a few weeks ago with a pilot program that included 32 schools. The testing was not done out of any particular concern. Rather, it was done in large part to help CPS create a universal protocol for testing the water in our schools. The initial testing found that 31 of the 32 pilot schools had lead levels under the EPA's action level of 15 parts per billion. Samples from one school, Tanner Elementary, showed slightly elevated levels of lead in a couple of drinking fountains. So CPS immediately ordered that these drinking fountains be disabled and ordered a second round of tests. We are now working with our facilities team and the Chicago Water Department to determine the cause of the elevated lead levels and will make remediations necessary to make sure the water in Tanner is completely safe. We are also coordinating with the Chicago Department of Public Health to support Tanner families with a medical van in case they have any concerns and desire testing for their children. As we move forward with expanded testing, older buildings and schools with young children will be tested first, followed by the rest of our schools. And the test results from the pilot program and all future lead testing are available at cps.edu/lead testing. Now I'd like to talk briefly about the district's financial situation. Our fight, as we just saw for the students in Amundsen, our fight for equal funding in Springfield continues, and I want to thank the thousands of parents, students, teachers, and community members who have contacted the governor to demand fair treatment for our schools. We are now taking the campaign to the next level and hope that as many supporters as possible will be able to join us. Tomorrow, CPS will join other school districts from around the state for a large rally at the Capitol Building in Springfield. Many districts throughout the state suffer from the same inequities in funding their communities, particularly those with high levels of low-income students from Cairo to Waukegan to Chicago. With one voice, these districts across the state will express the outrage that we feel toward a funding system that so blatantly discriminates against poor and minority children throughout the state of Illinois. Illinois has the most regressive funding formula in the country, and it forces districts like Chicago to the breaking point and says to our students, as you just heard from the creative students at Amundsen, in very clear and emotional terms, that their futures don't matter as much as children in the rest of the state. And we want to thank the thousands of supporters who've committed to making the trip downstate and hope that many others of our school communities will follow their lead. Our hope is to inspire Governor Rauner to finally take action on behalf of equal funding and fair funding throughout the state. In the meantime, we must, however, move forward with our plans for the next school year. As we've said many times before, CPS has reached a point of no return. Without equal funding from Springfield, our $1 billion deficit will result in severe budget cuts that will directly affect our classrooms. I've been meeting regularly with principals to offer support and to get their input on how CPS can mitigate these cuts. But there's no question that without equal funding from the state, these cuts will be extreme. That is why it's so important now to rally around our district. There's only 1 week left in the legislative session, and so we need to make a statement that the governor cannot ignore. Anything less, and we are perpetuating a system of inequality that compromises our children's education and could possibly cut short their dreams and their opportunities. And our children deserve far better than that. They deserve a system that challenges them, supports them, and protects their right to receive an excellent education, regardless of zip code, regardless of country of origin, and regardless of race. We need all Chicagoans to help win this fight. So please consider making the trip to Springfield tomorrow, or if you can't, visit cps.edu/equality to find out other ways of getting involved. I'll now turn things over to Dr. Jackson, who will provide us with some important academic updates. Janice?
Thank you, Forrest. I have three quick updates today. First, I'd like to start by congratulating our graduating seniors. So I think that it's important to, you know, mark this period as probably the most positive part of our school year. Every year as a principal, I always looked forward to, you know, students, you know, reaching this milestone and just all of the possibilities that are before them. I think it's also important to note that Chicago Public Schools is doing better than ever with the number of students who are graduating from high school, those students attending college, and a record number of students obtaining various scholarships such as the Gates Millennium Scholarship, Posse Scholarship, CME Scholarships, and other financial support that will help them meet their goals. Chicago has more Gates scholars than any other school district in the nation, and we know that that scholarship is a life-changing scholarship for many of our students. Last week, I had the opportunity to visit Lakeview High School and participate in their Decision Day, which is also a shining example of a neighborhood high school that is beating the odds and going above and beyond for all of their students. I think it's important to acknowledge the great work that our teachers and our students are doing in CPS schools, and it always reminds of what the end goal is, which is students successfully completing high school, but more importantly, going off to college and being successful. I want to congratulate our soon-to-be graduates. Many of you will be participating in graduation ceremony, so please make sure you share those sentiments on behalf of the district. Finally, I want to turn to an important topic, which is student assessment and testing. Over the past few months, I've had the opportunity to visit and meet with hundreds of teachers, literally hundreds of teachers throughout the district, to speak to them about testing. It's no secret that there's been an increase in the amount of standardized testing that our students take in Chicago Public Schools and also nationally. And it's important to note that the district is committing to reducing the amount of testing that our students are subjected to on a regular basis. One of the things that's important to note is that CPS values a balanced assessment system. That system means that while we put a lot of stock in standardized assessments, and they're important, we know that they are the gatekeeper for college, some of our most successful high schools, and et cetera. We also know that teacher-created assessments are extremely important, and for that reason, as a district office, we're working to see a better connection between the curriculum, the instruction, and also the assessments that our students take. This means putting more of a value on teacher-created assessments coupled with the importance of our standardized assessments. We've made a decision to continue with the NWEA for next year, which has been our assessment for elementary schools for the past 3 years. This decision was based largely on conversations with teachers, principals, and parents, and other stakeholders across the district who value the assessment system. They value the need for continuity and value the need for appropriate accountability for our schools. With that said, we will continue to administer the park assessment, which is a mandatory state assessment, and we will continue to update the board on our conversations with the state as well as the educators around park, specifically around the issues with the test, with the length of the test, some of the technology issues, as well as some of the other issues that we've heard about from various stakeholders. Finally, there's been a shift at the high school level. We are moving from the ACT assessment to the SAT. We're excited about the shift in that our students will be exposed at the 9th and 10th grade level to the PSAT, which gets CPS back to a place where there is a assessment system for our high school students so that we can check in formatively to see how students are performing. So starting next year, students will take the SAT as 11th graders. This summer, we will begin training educators not only on the components of the assessment, but again, also making sure that their instruction in the curriculum and the PD that's provided by the district supports teachers so that they do their best work in the classroom to support our students. There is one positive aspect of the SAT that I'd like to highlight for CPS students. And in the past, this was reserved for just our top schools, schools that routinely administered both assessments. And that is the prestigious National Merit Scholarship. I hope that we will be able to report the same way that I reported CPS leads the nation in the number of students with Gates Millennium Scholarships. Hopefully we can report in the next few years that CPS is one of the leading districts for the National Merit Scholarship, which many of you know is a very prestigious accomplishment. Over the next few months, I'll continue to update the board on our transition with both PARC and SAT, and I'm happy to take any questions from board members who have questions about our decision to administer NWEA and also the transition from ACT to SAT.
Board members? There are no questions. Dr. Jackson, does that conclude your report?
There was just one last quick point, and I'll make it quick. Academic growth is obviously our primary mission. However, President Clark, you do know that we updated our guidelines to better support transgendered students. CPS received a lot of media coverage as a result of that. We're also excited because we were referenced in the federal guidelines that were issued a few weeks after CPS made its proclamation. I think it's important for people to know that the updating of our transgender guidelines, it is an educational issue. We know that if students do not feel safe and comfortable in the school, you know, with whatever they might be bringing to the table, that this creates an emotionally unsafe environment for students and prevents them from doing their best work. It also shows that CPS is being proactive and moving in a very progressive manner in order to ensure that all of our students feel safe and welcome and valued in our schools. So I just wanted to highlight that because those guidelines were updated since the last meeting, and make sure that there aren't any questions from board members about those recent updates and some of the coverage regarding the guidelines.
Thank you, Dr. Jackson. I actually have a question slash comment. Mm-hmm. Much of the news around the Chicago Public Schools centers around our financial plight, mm-hmm. And obviously that has to be resolved. What is often overshadowed are the academic achievements. Mm-hmm. Would you just take a moment, Dr. Jackson? I'm not sure that everyone knows all the criteria mm-hmm. that goes into being a Gates Scholar. Mm-hmm. And I believe your statement was, nationally, we get more than any other school system.
Yeah.
That's something that you want to be proud of.
Yeah.
Just take a moment and make sure that the audience and the media understands what that really means.
Well, the Gates Millennium Scholarship is a scholarship that affords the students, you know, we pay for it, well, not we, but Gates pays for undergrad, graduate school, all the way through their doctorate. It's for low-income students who have performed well in school. So Chicago has thousands of students who qualify for that scholarship. Gates selects 1,000 students nationally. This year, I believe CPS had 36 students recognized throughout the country, and we have been a leading recipient of that scholarship for the past 3 years. So it definitely speaks to not only the progress that our students have made, but it also shows that CPS is doing a great job competing nationally with their, and our students are doing a good job competing with their national counterparts.
Thank you very much.
One of the things I want to know, and I'm almost sure of it, but don't a great number of those students come out of Kenwood? the Gates Scholar, which is a neighborhood school?
Yes, we do. Ken Wood, I believe, had two this year, but Ken Wood and Len Bloom are the leaders. Yeah. But, you know, it fluctuates each year. But, yeah, you're right to note that Ken Wood is one of the leading schools, as well as Len Bloom and Lincoln Park as well.
Mm-hmm. And those are neighborhood.
Okay. Yep. They're all two of them are neighborhood schools. Right. Yeah.
Thank you.
Okay. Finally,
thank you. Go ahead.
Yeah, I want to transition and invite our Chief of Early Childhood, Diego Gallardo, to the stage. He's going to do a quick presentation regarding early childhood. You will be asked to vote on this today, to vote on the block grant. So we just want to make sure that you have an update on the program and also give them an opportunity to highlight some of the accomplishments that we've made in early childhood.
Thank you. Good morning. My name is Diego Giraldo, and I'm the Chief Officer for Early Childhood Education. Next to me, I have Ms. Leslie McKinley, and she's our Director for Early Childhood Education. We are here today to address the board and to ask the board to approve a $55 million funding for our early childhood education programming in combination with our partners and community-based organizations to support our children with early childhood. As you know, this is a very important work that we do with children from zero, from birth to college. It's one of the most important jobs that I will say that we as a school district do, not only with our communities, but also aligned to research and best practices. As we know, as early we capture children, the more and the higher they perform as they grow up. Also, I want to take this opportunity to thank our mayor, Ron Emanuel, for the support and vision that he have had with our programs and to support early learning programming here in the city of Chicago and our families. Leslie?
Our focus over the past couple of years has evolved. It began with the vision of our mayor, Ron Emanuel, with Chicago Ready to Learn. Under this initiative, the thought was to bring Department of Family Support Services as well as CPS under one umbrella for our early learning system. It was also under this a partnership that we expanded access to preschool education. Also, we improved quality by adopting a common curriculum across the city as well as a common assessment tool. It was also under this initiative that CPS, Department of Early Childhood, Office of Early Childhood, had centralized this enrollment process. Presently, we are working to continue to expand on the vision of Chicago Early to Learn by building our birth through second grade alignment with literacy. We are also presently working to align all preschool programs to a higher standard of quality, that which is similar to that of Head Start with quality supports for families. We are also working in collaboration with the city to expand our new universal online application process. And in the future, we continue to move forward towards building our literacy development and really analyzing and beginning to look at the impacts that preschool has on kindergarten, first, and second grade. And we will also continue to build on the collaboration that we've already established with the City of Chicago to expand resources for families and also streamline supports. There are three categories of programs which we serve within our office: school-based programming, community-based programming, and also programs serving kindergarten, first, and second grade. When we think about our school-based programs, all of those programs are served within our CPS schools, and they support children ages 3 to 5. It's important to note that they are also funded through state, local, and federal funds. One thing I do want to highlight that these programs offer both a half and a full school day schedule for families, with the exception of our tuition base. Our tuition base program offers a full work day schedule for families. And tuition base is fully supported by parents' tuition. Our community-based organizations provide two options of support for families. One is prevention initiative, and that's program support for families with birth to three-year-old children. And those families could receive support either in a community-based agency, or they could also receive their supports in their home through our home visiting program. The other support that we provide in community-based organizations is that of a preschool program, which is funded through our Preschool for All grant. This program is similar to the preschool programming that we offer here within the district. The slight difference is that there's an extended day, and we are able to extend that day by braiding funding from other sources. And it's also important to note that these community-based organizations, the preschool programs, are in areas where we are at capacity within our CPS schools.
Another key program is from kindergarten to second grade. This is aligned to our strategic plan. We do have a strategic plan within our office, and that strategic plan aligns very well with that future objective that you have seen previously, which is building capacity to literacy, creating some learning objectives in regard to creating those benchmarks and those goals in mind, and moving our children and that transition between pre-K to K towards second and third grade performance. Especially in literacy, we're also looking at math components, but those are two key buckets that we are looking at in regard to performing for children and working with our families and our community as well. As we enter highlights for 2015-2016 school year, some of the key elements that I would like to share with you today is basically the partnerships that we have with our families and our communities through our programming. We really support families, and we know supporting families and the city of Chicago through Chicago Public Schools and communities is a key element to develop children. We also provide professional development to our teachers, and that professional development aligned to best practices of what we learn in regard to data and best practices on research. So we support that as well. A key area, especially with funding, is to maximize the funding and the sources of those funds to support our children and to support our families, to support our programs, as you're seeing today with early childhood. And also, most importantly, is the ability to provide that full-day programming to our families and children, moving from a half-day to full-day, which is a very useful, not only for families, but also for children, and that is aligned to research and best practices.
And one highlight I'd like to mention before we talk about our universal application is that from in school year 14-15, we had offered 198 opportunities for full-day program. Currently, we offer 239 opportunities for full-day programming here within the district. What you see on the screen is a flyer communication that we shared with families about our universal application process. We talked about it as a collaborative effort with us in the city. And really, this new process will ensure that families have better accessibility to early childhood programs across the city. Also, because this platform is online, it allows parents to apply for preschool at their home, on their mobile device, or even at a school. As I said, this is the application, the flyer that we shared recently. This process launched on May 16th, and as you can see on the flyer, it has the 9 sites where families can go across the city to get support with applying for preschool. And I'm happy to note, to date, we have over 6,000 families who have used this system to apply for preschool. And after June 13th will be an official launch of this new process where families will not only be able to apply, but they will also receive preliminary placement. So no longer do they need to wait. So if they can also search this site to see if there are sites available at other community agencies, as well as what our availability is within schools. Thank you.
These have concluded the presentation.
Before you step down, the question. On the preschool, the 3 to 5-year-old, there was a number I saw was just under 20,000. I don't know what slide that was. Mm-hmm. Is that right? Oh, okay. It looks like it's 22,000. Is that full capacity, or do we have greater capacity? Are we getting all the kids we should be getting?
One thing I'll say, it's actually 34 because there are some students in a community-based program. But what the mayor did is ensure that we put all of the programs under one umbrella to break down barriers, because the problem was that if a family wanted their child in a pre-K program, they didn't know the difference between a community-based program, CPS's program, and it created issues. But to answer your question, we've done a really good job of filling up those seats. Obviously, in a lot of communities, they'd like to see more full day classrooms, and we've worked to expand those numbers, and we'll be reporting back, you know, how many of those opportunities are opened up as a result. But I'm happy to say that we're seeing far more students enroll in these programs than they did in the past. And one thing that I think is important to note when we talk about breaking down barriers is that this is very much a part of our strategy. From an educational perspective, we know that students learn much of what they need in order to be successful by age 5. And if students are in school faster and ready to read earlier, then they have a greater likelihood of being successful. So early childhood programming is a big part of our overall strategy for improving outcomes in the district.
Thank you, Dr. Jackson. What was behind my question, because I really didn't know the answer, I just thought the number, I would have expected to see a higher number. And if there was some issue with getting kids, parents to take advantage of this, I wanted to make sure that we were providing all of the tools to do that.
I'm just going to make a comment, Frank. I visited over the last couple of months one agency, 3 different sites, and there is availability. And I went through these and spent, this wasn't like a flyby. This was each one I was in about an hour and a half. The programming was amazing. And this isn't like what I would have preferred as a kid, where it's a free-for-all, you go in and do your own thing. I mean, this was all structured, but it looked like it was incredibly effective. Sections of people, kids being read to. Sections of kids doing the reading. Mm-hmm. Sections, they would have free time, but it had to be something. And so there were some that were designing, there were some that were building. And I saw it in the 0 to 3, and then I saw the 3 to 5, incredibly different, right? But it was very impressive. But what I kept going through with this agency was they weren't at capacity, right? And so they're not efficient. And so that's how you maximize the cost of the site is a fixed dollar amount. Then it's just a function of the revenue you can get, which is based on the children that are there. Parents were delivering kids, and of course, everyone can't get there at the same time, but the handoff looked like it was exemplary. It looked safe. I couldn't get in without being with somebody that was in the building. Everything I saw was exactly what I would have wanted for my kids to have gone there. So I would just say my observation is it was the 3 I went to were really good, but there's capacity for more. And that was Frank's question, I think.
One of the things I would say, because I was the liaison for early childhood, still am, but not as active, but basically for the first 3 years, and I visited quite a few and interviewed a lot of parents, one of the biggest problems is that it's half day. Because when parents have to work, they have no way of or have a resource of getting someone to pick up their kids. And so I think that's why the mayor's program was to move as much as possible to full day, because it will probably never will get them at capacity as long as they're still half day. So I don't know if we need to think about it. The money is more efficient to have less at full day and at capacity versus more part-time when you can't really service some of the people needed because they can't get them there and pick them up, you know.
Yeah, the other question I would have somewhat related to that is, just given demographic shifts in the city, how are we revisiting the distribution of those early childhood education centers across the city to make sure that as there's a greater demand in a particular area, we're allocating more seats or more sites to those particular places? Or if demand declines in an area, maybe we don't need as many seats in that area. I know we've made a ton of progress on the access quality and the alignment piece, but I just still worry about the access part of it, especially in parts of the city that have experienced that sort of demographic shift or, you know, increase in the number of school-age kids, et cetera.
Mm-hmm. You can take that.
Yeah, I think that's a key factor, as we know population move, and we need to be with that trend of population move. So we do have an allocation instrument that we visit within my department. And I think the allocation component is a key element of seeing how the trends of the population are moving with our enrollment and how we fill those seats with capacity and provide those programs for that group of kids and families as well.
Great.
So,
One of the other things we did this year was we surveyed principals. So because principals are the pulse of the community, we wanted to see, have you noticed the shift in your community as the current funding and allocation that you have now? Do you foresee that working with the population of students you intend to serve in the future? Mm-hmm. And we got an overwhelming response, and we made adjustments based on that data as well.
Great.
Thank you very much.
Thank you.
Thank you.
That concludes our portion.
Thank you very much, Dr. Jackson. I have a few announcements to make. We announced a change last April that we would put the agenda out first before you go to your advanced registration. In other words, before you signed up for public participation, you would actually know what we're going to talk about. It seems that that was a helpful thing to do, and that would be a part of our ongoing process. In addition to that, I always ask that you continue to use our website. It seems that that utilization has been steadily increasing. You also, I think it's apparent from the conversations you've heard from several board members and a few that spoke this morning, that members of the Board of Education make it a practice to get out into the community and to get out and come to where you are at to be responsive and address concerns that you might have. I neglected to mention the website, I should always, as cpsboe.org, and I believe that you'll find you can sign up for office hours, and of course, you could have questions that are important to you responded to in a, I think, a timely fashion. Our standard is to respond within 48 hours, and as always, to actually try for what we call a resolution to the issue the first time we see the problem. I think with that, Madam Secretary, would you please share the details for the next board meeting?
Thank you, Mr. President. The next board meeting will be held on Wednesday, June 22nd, 2016 at the CPS Loop office. Advanced registration will open at 10:30 a.m. on Monday, June 20th, 2016 and will close on Tuesday, June 21st, 2016 at 5 p.m. or until all slots are filled, whichever is first. If anyone has any questions about this process, please contact the board office for our assistance. Thank you.
Okay. Are we ready to proceed with public participation?
Yes, Mr. President, we are. And if I may just read some directions. Speakers, please listen while I provide directions for public participation. I will call your name and number when it is your turn to speak. When you hear your name, please immediately proceed to the staging area to the left of the podium and check in with our board staff member, Eric. You will be lined up in the right order. When it is your turn to speak, proceed to the podium and state your name. After you state your name, I will then start the two-minute clock, which is visible to all in the audience. And I would also like to note that there is a timer on top of the podium for the speakers to see. When there are 30 seconds remaining, the color will turn yellow. And when the 2 minutes are up, the light will turn to red. Please immediately take your seat when your time is up to allow for the next speaker to begin. Also, for anyone who plans to stand in support of a speaker, please be aware that the only walkway in the boardroom is behind the podium. Therefore, if you would kindly make a single file line and stand as near to the railing as possible, this will still allow people to pass through the area safely. Thank you. And Mr. President, I'd like to note that we do have some officials with us this morning. So I would ask that Alderman Garza from the 10th Ward please proceed to the podium. And then she will be followed by the president of Local 143, Bill Iacolo. Thank you.
Good morning, and thank you so much for having me. Hi, Ms. Jackson.
How you doing?
I'm Susan Sadlowski Garza, and I am the alderwoman in the 10th Ward. Before I became an alderman, I was a counselor in Chicago Public Schools for 21 years, one counselor with 894 students alone by myself. But I'm here actually to speak in favor of some things that have been going on at the new Southeast Elementary School, but I would be amiss if I didn't take this opportunity to comment on the preschool. Mr. Furlong and President Clark, one of the barriers to why those seats aren't full is because with the changes in making people a centralized location to fill out applications, parents now can no longer enroll their students, their preschoolers, at that school. And a lot of parents, especially on the south and the west sides, don't have transportation, so they can't get to those locations. There was waiting lists to get into our preschools. I mean, now there's empty seats. And I believe that one of those issues is because of the application process. So I'm happy to see that they're putting it online. But another barrier is because some of my parents in my ward are paying $400 a month to send their kid to school for 2 hours. Mm-hmm. So parents that have to pay, they can't afford it. Mm-hmm. They just can't afford it. Preschool for all means preschool free for all. That's what it should be. Mm-hmm. So when we say preschool for all, we don't mean preschool for those that can afford it. And that's what this has turned into. And that's why there's empty seats. So sorry, I had to say that. I just want to take this opportunity. Actually, we're getting a new school on the southeast side, Southeast Elementary. And it's been 10 years in the making. Glistal Elementary School has been stuffed at its gills. They are in three different buildings. We have taken over St. Francis de Sales Elementary School. Glistal's fifth grade is on the third floor of St. Francis de Sales High School. We use the senior center for a gym. So this school is so well needed, and I want to thank you for that. And I do have to thank CEO Jackson, Dr. Jackson, because this process starting 10 years ago with parents lobbying and working to get this school up until this final moment has been such a collaborative effort, and the board has gone above and beyond bringing the community in to see what we want, to see what we need. You guys have let us be part of the whole decision-making process. We sat in on principal interviews. We formed an advisory council. You allowed the community to help write the description for the principal. We got to sit in on principal interviews. You listened to what the community had to say. I think this is an unprecedented model that should be followed throughout every new school that's built, because people are really taking pride in this school. So, Ms. Jackson, for that, thank you.
You're welcome.
One of the things that has gone on, and one of the things that I have heard as part of this advisory council, even with the alderman before me, who's no longer there now because I beat him in the election, and with the former president, Barbara Bird Bennett, and I know Ms. Annette Gurley was there, Jim Dispensa, Lindy McGuire, all these people have been well aware that the community is adamant with Glistal and Adams teachers following students. A lot of teachers at Glistal and Adams live in the community. They've been working there for a very long time, and people are really worried because Glistal's going to lose 700 kids and Adams is going to lose 400, which means a lot of positions are going to be lost. So one of the things that we have stood firm on, and myself as well, is that teachers follow students. Shields Elementary School, there's a model there that they built a new school to relieve overcrowding, and teachers from the Shield School were given priority in interviewing so that they would get first dibs, per se, on those jobs. One of the things that concerns me, I noticed on the job postings now that it says ESL bilingual preferred. Ms. Jackson, as well as other people in the board, have assured me that our teachers will be given priority interviews. But the ESL bilingual description on there worries me because some of those teachers that are in that school don't have that endorsement, and they're moving to a school with the same student body. So why does that demographic change? I don't want to see that description used as a means to get rid of people that might be higher on the pay scale because of per pupil budgeting. So I just think it's really important that I say that. The community is adamant about teachers following students. We have some wonderful, wonderful teachers in our ward. Also, too, We have formed one of the things on the southeast side of the 10th Ward, for those of you that have never been there, is the farthest you can go before you hit the Indiana border. I always like to refer to this ward as the forgotten stepchild of the city. We formed a group of coming from education. Education is a big priority of mine, and there's not a lot of resources in our ward. We were a true mill town, and when the mills left, so did all the jobs, so did the restaurants, so did the stores, and we were left with nothing but a shell of a neighborhood. So we don't have a lot of resources there, and with the budget crisis, a lot of our resource centers have closed their doors. We formed a committee for parents of diverse learners, and it's called PECS, Parents of Exceptional Children. And they meet in my office once a month, and it started out with 10 parents from the ward, and it's grown to 52 people. And we have a psychologist, we have a speech path, an OT, a physical therapist, helping parents to advocate for their kids. But one of the things that I wanted to touch base on, and they actually asked me to read something from you, we have 19 students just at Adams and Galista alone that are bussed out of our schools to go to a cluster program. That's just Jane Addams and Galista. That doesn't include Hegwisch, South Deering, the Bush, South Chicago, or Jeffrey Manor. So that number could be a lot higher. On the website of Strategic and the Office of Diverse Learners and Support Services, it states on there that we want to reintegrate students with disabilities from decentralized cluster programs into neighborhood schools or the schools that they would attend if not disabled. So I would ask that this is a great opportunity for us to get a program in this new school that would accommodate those students and let them come to the school that's their neighborhood school, because we don't have one. And you know, those 19 students just from Adams and Galista, I would love to see them stay in our neighborhood and not have to be bussed out. And it would make a lot of the parents very happy as well. That's it. I just want to say thank you so much again for the collaborative effort this has been. I speak in favor of the boundaries. We are very excited to work with Kenya Underwood. She's been amazing at our community meetings, and we have a great ward that is really looking forward to building a great school. So thank you so much again.
Thank you, Alderman. Thank you very
thank
much.
Thank you.
Next, please, Mr. Iacullo.
Thank you. Madam Secretary, good morning, board members.
Good morning.
CEO Claypool. I'm here once again to talk to you about the request for proposal and the expansion of the privatization of your engineer services. After a thorough review of your own documentation and discussions with your board officials, this scheme will without a doubt cost the district more money. Mm. The district cries broke, and CPS officials want taxpayers in Chicago and the rest of the state to bail them out. Yet every opportunity we have presented to the board and its representatives to save the district money by the very people who have worked for decades in the schools and do the same services for less than private is disregarded. Your latest money pit scheme is to expand the current Airmark and Sodexo schools for the performance and management of custodial and engineering services at 49 schools. Time and time again, we ask for what this will cost the taxpayers in the district, and no one can provide us a definite cost. In fact, your department heads claim there's no additional cost to this expansion. Are these connected companies doing the work for free? These are the same companies with complaints against them for dirty, filthy schools, but you guys are going to reward them for substandard conditions with an expansion. Prior to 2012, your engineers did the same work for free. Your engineers. The CPS went from free to a contract that now is not to exceed, as I'm told, $260 million. Where's the cost savings in that? It's not about the public good, it's about the political profits and campaign funds. Approximately 8 months ago, your former CEO pled guilty to charges of kickback scheme with no-bid CPS contracts for more than $23 million. Mm-hmm. You're doing the same thing here. Aramark never bid on providing integrated facility management services, and there's no references whatsoever in the Aramark contract to even the possibility. So the expansion of 18 schools to Aramark and 31 to Sodexo without bid is exactly the same thing Barbara Bird Bennett did. Maybe it's time for the U.S. attorney to start looking at all of you. I come to you with a heavy heart on this. We've worked with you to try to get funding. I've talked to our friends in Springfield. I'm going to put those students' video on our website. I thought it was excellent done. It was done excellently, really good. We're here to help you save money. We're not here to fight with you. This is a scheme that was put together so fast without any input from any of us, from your department, who none of them ever worked in a school building. They never worked in a school. I've been here 42 years. You didn't ask one question on what's the best way to do this for cheapest. All I ask is consider that before you give them this expansion and before you do an RFP. I really appreciate the time that you've given me today. I know you're very busy with a lot of issues, and we're really here for the students. And I congratulate Cynthia for all of her service. Wonderful speech. It shows what kind of students we have. And I also congratulate the students at my school, Lincoln Park, that were mentioned, that they do real well, and it's an excellent school. I've been there 20 years. So thank you so much for your time. I hope I can have a chance to work with you. We've always been your partner since 1902, and I feel like I've been here that long. So thank you so much.
Thank you.
Before you go to the next speaker, of course, you and I have met. And we've talked, and you presented me with information that I told you I would look at and make sure that the appropriate people in CPS also looked at it.
Okay.
I also know that you've met with several people in CPS, including the head of our facilities. Mm-hmm. You clearly care very much about CPS mm-hmm. and have done, and people who are in your union continue mm-hmm. to do an honorable job, and we appreciate that. Mm-hmm. There are a number of things that you said that I'm not going to get into, you know, a discord that we haven't already had, but mm-hmm. there are two things I do have to respond to.
Okay.
Even as late as this morning, knowing that you were going to present, I asked questions, as have other board members. I know you don't agree with this, mm-hmm. and I respect the fact that we don't agree.
Okay.
But year over year, mm-hmm. this move, this change, will save the equivalent of 120 teaching positions. It is a huge cost savings. I know you don't agree. I don't have any other way of looking at any more data than I already have, and I believe that what I'm seeing is accurate. So I want to state that. I know you don't agree, but I do want to state it.
I don't agree because...
We don't agree,
no.
But we respect one another. Mm-hmm. The reference you made to prior administrations sort of putting a cloud over what we're doing today, it is your right to do that. It is simply inaccurate. I just wanted you to know that.
I understand, and we will agree to disagree on that, but the figures that we've been given, we've studied them, our attorneys have studied them, our accountants have studied them, and recently in negotiations, we asked for clarification, and there was no way they could clarify. In fact, they tripped up. I asked them about the 33 schools you said are doing it cheaper. How old are they? She said, well, average 38 years old. That's not true. The average age of all those 33 schools is 13 years.
Okay.
We're running buildings that are 115 years old.
Truly, truly.
And you're not going to save on those buildings.
Well,
we're looking to help you save so you don't have to cut 30% in your budgets, principals. That's what we're looking to do. We want to work with you.
I know.
No privatization scheme ever worked out with public money. You're giving public money to a private company to make profit. You know from the Park District.
Thank you very much.
Didn't succeed there.
Thank you.
Thank you, Mr. President. I'll continue. And we are now ready to call speakers from the speakers list. So our first speaker will be speaker number one, Marcus Ceniceros, followed by speaker number two, Edison Urina, and then speaker number three, Wendy Catton. Please state your name.
Good afternoon. My name is Marcus Ceniceros, and I am the Director of Community Engagement for KIPP Chicago Schools. And I have not only amazing opportunity to work with our KIPPsters, but also the parents, their parents and guardians. And KIPP Chicago is committed to making a significant social impact beyond the walls of our classroom. This year, we launched our Community Impact Family Fellowship, which is a program at our Inglewood campus. It's a formal fellowship that provides professional development to our families, designed to elevate their voices in the community. So this group is tackling issues like community safety, as well as educational equity in Chicago. At KIPP, we believe that all of our students can and should go to and through college. When a student leaves us in eighth grade, we make a 10-year commitment to them to stay with them until they graduate from college. And we want our students to have the opportunity to make their own choices, to choose the life that is best for them. And it's our hope that their choices will make an impact on their community. So this week, an alumnus from KIPP Ascend Middle received a prestigious service award at Grinnell College, where he's graduating. He has excelled in athletics and in the classroom as an all-conference academic list and Dean's List student. And KIPP Chicago is excited to welcome him back to the West Side this coming school year as one of our newest teachers. I share this with the board today because the drive and desire of our current students, our families, and alumni is what keeps our team going, even in the heat of this financial crisis. At KIPP, we support changing the formula used not only to fund Chicago schools, but all schools in the state. The way that things work right now is not equal, and it's not fair. Our students deserve a fair funding formula. This is the message that over 50 of our families will share with elected officials tomorrow as we join with CPS families in Springfield. So we wanted to say thank you to the board and CEO Claypool for your leadership to fix the formula. And as we say at KIPP, together we can build a better tomorrow. Thank you.
Thank you.
Thank you for your comments. Our next speaker, please. Edison Urena, last call. Moving on to the next speaker then, Wendy Canton. And as she approaches the podium, the next speakers will be speaker number 4, Martin Ritter, followed by speaker 26, Denise Reiki, and speaker 48, Annette Rizzo.
Good morning. My name is Wendy Canton. I'm the director of a parent group called Raise Your Hand for Illinois Public Education. I have a seventh grader at Burley Elementary, which is a wonderful school that still manages to preserve the joy of learning and inquiry that will be destroyed, obviously, if it receives the $830,000 in cuts that are estimated. My group started in 2010 around the issue of budget cuts in the almost same exact deficit that we're facing today. I believe the district had a $700 million deficit back then. We've gone to Springfield every year. We've done revenue campaigns every year. We are so glad that CPS is finally coming clean with the public and being honest about the deficit. But as we go to Springfield tomorrow, and I'll be there, and we continue to call on state legislators, the city and CPS has to be part of the solution for sustainable funding. There is no way to stabilize our public education system without efforts from both. I hope you all know that. You know that you're capped by PTEL at this district. You know that our property taxes are lower than most of the state. You need to do your part. I don't know if you have any real power. I don't know. I mean, this is a bit of a charade. We all know that. But if you have any power, talk to the mayor, get a referendum on the ballot, give us some TIF money back to get through this crazy Springfield session. Surplus some of the money. There's a TIF bill in Springfield for $600 million for transit. We know that. Legislators call us. Are you kidding? Where are the creative solutions for our schools? We will be in Springfield. We will be at the doors of legislators' offices all summer long. Parents are not going to allow 25% cuts to our schools. We will make
thank you, Ms. Canton.
Your life and all lives
miserable.
Thank
you for your comments.
I'm almost done. We will be
Ms. Canton,
at the
you.
Office. No, I'm.
Thank you, Ms. Canton.
Let her finish.
At the fundraisers, at the health clubs, across the city. If you think that you're going to cut the schools to the bone and not do some of the things you can do, that we've been coming here with solutions. You know why we're angry? We've watched outlandish spending. You didn't do it. You're just the latest crop. We get it. outlandish spending for 6 years. Do you know how frustrating that is as parents who have kids who rely on these schools? It's not you. It's a bad system, and it's why we need an elected school board. Everything runs on campaign cycles. We need funding. We need you to talk to the mayor. We need a PTEL referendum. We need to push Springfield, and we need to stop the political nonsense. Thank you.
Our next speaker, please.
Good afternoon. My name is Martin Ritter. The title of my speech today is, You Are Doing Things Wrong and You Know It. Okay? When I read the agenda that was published on Monday, I felt very uncomfortable, similar to how I felt after we all watched the last few minutes of the most recent Game of Thrones episode when Hodor was holding the door and everyone felt real uneasy about how that episode ended. That's how I feel about all the things that you do. Aramark grossly understaffs the schools, and they do this to boost their bottom line. And our schools are dirty. So let's expand their programs. Let's privatize them more. Let's privatize the hardworking engineers while we're at it, right? Because we didn't have so many carbon monoxide problems this year and boiler problems this year. Why are we doing things that have been proven not to work? We, the union, did a survey of hundreds and hundreds of schools and thousands of our members, and 90% of them said schools are dirtier. We've presented this to you in our collective bargaining, and you're going to just make it worse. So let's just keep doing what we're doing. But you know that this is wrong. Also, you have a great slogan, 20 for 20, right? But what about the other 80% of the deficit that you guys don't talk about? If you get $200 million out of SB 231, you still have an $800 million deficit left. What's your solution for that? I'm going to stop right there, and hopefully that you'll answer the public, because we desperately want to know.
Well, you got your math wrong. 20 for 20 is not 200 million. 20 for 20 is 550 million. So, just so you know.
Oh, okay. So, your numbers, because those numbers would be trusted just like the engineer's numbers that we heard about 5 minutes ago.
It's third grade math. I'm sure you can do that.
Well, I taught social studies for 12 years, and I know pretty much about how CPS works because I worked in it. Thank you.
Our next speaker, please. Please state your name.
Denise Racky, certified school nurse. I come here today to voice my opinion on the privatization of Chicago Public Schools nurses. School nursing is part of public health. School nurses have been a vital part of Chicago Public Schools since 1951. Many Chicago Public School nurses have gotten their Type 73 certificate from the state of Illinois. A Type 73 in school nursing by Illinois law allows school nurses to do medical reviews and individualized educational planning for children with special needs. CPS school nurses should be part of the health and wellness teams, but aren't. As this model of school nurses changes, is it the highest standard of CPS requires? Privatization of school public nurses does not fit a healthy school model. Privatization of school nursing does not mean efficiency, but gives fragmentation of services. There is no quality of care. This patchwork of nursing services does more harm to children. It only provides the private company profit, and Illinois state requirements are compromised. With privatization, there's loss of transparency. Contracts are written to meet minimum of standards. There are hidden costs. Let's be honest, they get paid per contract even if the job isn't done. They are not CPS employees, and where is the accountability? Just look at some of our past practices. Privatization delivers inadequate care of our most vulnerable population. How did we get there? There's no credible advertising for school nurse positions, no developed educational pathways for registered nurses to advance to get a Type 73 certification, no support for nurses that need help in their schools. Many Chicago public school nurses have 3 to 6 schools to cover. In my professional nursing opinion, that is setting people up to fail and fail our students. RCM nurses get shuttled to multiple schools by Uber. Really, privatization is a recipe for disaster. Privatization works in a factory, but puts our students in harm's way. We have a duty to our children. Do no harm. Thank you very much.
Thank you, Ms. Racky. Thank you for your comments. Our next speaker, please.
Hi, I'm Annette Rizzo, the Health and Benefits Coordinator for the Chicago Teachers Union. To follow up on the survey that Marty mentioned, I'd like to share the results that the union conducted for the lack of the cleanliness in our schools. The survey shows the conditions in the schools are deplorable. It identifies that since Aramark has taken control of the buildings, the cleanliness has declined drastically in disturbing ways. It is important to note that, as agreed by everyone, the problem is not due to the performance of the custodians, but rather that all the schools have seen a great reduction in the number of custodians serving the school. As a result of the unsanitary conditions that exist everywhere, we see a lack of simple things like cleaning supplies. There are no mops, brooms, soap, or toilet paper, of which the faculty is now providing for the students. The teachers are using their prep time and their lunch time to do the cleaning themselves. This is especially prevalent in the schools that have preschool and kindergarten, and these rooms where you find a lot of food and sanitary needs. A daily cleaning of these rooms should really be mandated. The unsanitary conditions have created an environment where pest control is now needed in most schools. I myself visited a school where I saw where the primary kids put their unused milk in a bucket. I was there in the morning, and that bucket was left in the hallway overnight. In addition to that, as I passed the bathrooms, I almost felt like I was outside passing a outhouse. I met with Aramark to discuss a grievance appeal. I asked them to explain to me how they determine the number of custodians that are placed in each building. I was told it was done by square footage and population of the building. I was confused by the response, since the specific school we were talking about was overpopulated and waiting for an addition to be built, and I didn't notice that the building had shrunk in size. So, yet the custodial staff was cut by two. It is sad and disgraceful that our children are spending 7 hours a day in filthy conditions that have become a breeding ground for disease and infections. We call on you, the Board of Education, that has a jurisdiction over Aramark, that you make the necessary changes so the children of the CPS schools can live in the same conditions that you find in your home. And I would also
thank you, Ms. Rizzo.
Okay, I was going to say one more thing.
Thank you for your comments. Our next speaker, please. Speaker number 5, Reggie Newton, followed by speaker number 6, Brenda Cora. Speaker number 7, Freddie Ramos, 21 Glenn Longstreet, and 32 Edwin Davila. Please state your name.
My name is Reginald Newton. I am a parent of a second grader at Decatur Classical Elementary. I'm also a member of the Expansion Committee. I want to thank you, all the members of the board, for your time. Decatur Classical is a level 1 CPS school. It has high academic achievement. It's been rated by Chicago Magazine and the Chicago Sun-Times and other places, one of the top schools in the state of Illinois. It has a great chess club. It was really rewarding hearing about that chess club earlier from another school, because we have an active chess club also. They just met with the mayor for their success. We achieve our success because of our great teachers and our parent support. And that success is in spite of our physical limitations. There's no gymnasium. There's no cafeteria. We have classrooms sometimes in the hallway. Students eat their lunch in the hallway. So our success comes in spite of our limitations. What we're asking for is for an expansion of Decatur. If those physical needs are expanded, we could have a gymnasium. We could have a computer lab. We could have all the facilities meeting our achievement. We'd also note, if Decatur is expanded and replicated, we could expand to not just a sixth grade, but to a seventh and eighth grade. Decatur is a selective enrollment school. It is competitive to get into it, and many parents would like the opportunity to go there. That experience should be replicated and should be expanded, but only if the physical limitations of our school are met. We're not asking for money. We're asking for creative solutions from you, the members of the board, to help Decatur to replicate its success to all students in Chicago. Thank you.
Thank you, Mr. Newton. Our next speaker, please.
Good morning. My name is Brenda Cora, and I'm the principal at Roe Clark Math and Science Academy. I stand before you as a person who grew up on the west side of Chicago, an alumna of Noble Street's first graduating class, a first-generation college student, a founding staff member, and now a person who leads 500 students and over 600 staff members at Roe Clark. I stand before you because I want to encourage you to think about the impact your budget will have on our students' future. I want to share a little story about our alumni, Nathaniel Taylor. Nate transferred to Roe Clark after his freshman year with a GPA of a 0.9. He entered Roe Clark defeated and apathetic about school and his future. Roe Clark's systems for discipline and student learning, our advisory structure, and unwavering staff are just a few of the privileges we could afford Nate upon his joining our student body. Nate left Roe Clark on an upward trajectory where he went from D's and F's to A's and B's in all of his core classes. He was captain of our football team and leader of our student government. Nate is currently a freshman at the University of Illinois at Springfield and regularly mentors those following in his path. This is just one story. We have great students from broken neighborhoods and too often broken homes. Nonetheless, they are dedicated, passionate, loving kids. Roe Clark takes students with all the modern problems of the modern urban world, students with learning and emotional disabilities, students from gang-ridden neighborhoods, students who don't speak English, and we prepare them for college. 100% of Roe Clark students get accepted to college. This year, our students will be attending the University of Michigan, the University of Notre Dame, the University of Illinois at Urbana-Champaign, the University of Tampa, Middlebury College, the University of Wisconsin-Madison, and Morehouse College, just to name a few. Our senior class has 6 Posse finalists, 2 Posse scholars, 1 QuestBridge scholar, 1 NROTC scholarship for the Marine.
Thank you for your comments.
Thank you.
Thank you.
Hello, my name is Freddie Ramos. Thank you for this opportunity to speak before the board today, especially Frank Clark, who I used to work for during my Commonwealth Edison days. I'm a proud parent.
And you have to say nice things.
Long time ago. I'm a proud parent of a graduate of CPS, Lincoln Park High School. He now attends Boston University in their biomedical engineering course. Have another son who's a sophomore at the Chicago Bulls College Prep, which is part of the Noble Network. And we chose this school for the second son of mine for 2 things. We were looking for a school that has high quality and a school that focuses on colleges as much as I did. This summer, my son will be attending Princeton University for a couple weeks as part of the Noble's Summer of a Lifetime program. I'm the oldest of 5 kids. The first time I went to college was when I attended. This is a great program. I believe this is a step forward for our students. That way, they know what the next step is, not only going to college, but graduating from college. And I think this is a good step toward that. This year, my son is one of 850 kids, sophomores, in the Noble Network that will be attending colleges throughout this summer. I'm proud of the work that my son has done and proud of the work that the school has done as well because they believe in scholarship and they believe in discipline and honor. However, this great work that Noble has done is being jeopardized. Noble is going to Springfield tomorrow, and we look forward to your support. Thank you very much.
Thank you, Mr. Ramos.
A quick response to you. Everyone, particularly those of you that are addressing the board today because either their capital needs or operating needs that you want the board to meet. The reality of it is the best opportunity to meet those needs is to help us in Springfield. That is the best opportunity and the best way to constructively achieve what you're asking, at least in some form. Right now, we don't know what's going to happen in Springfield. We're hopeful our CEO and our head of education are going to be in Springfield tomorrow, and they'll be addressing this issue head on with legislators. What we need, those of you that have come and spoke to us and suggested how we could do better, those of you that have decided that this board is sort of useless, nevertheless, you have expressed thoughts on what we should do better. The fact is, we need you. And you help yourselves by taking this issue on in Springfield. Thank you.
Thank you, Mr. President. Our next speaker, please. Glenn Longstreet, last call. Moving on to the next speaker, please. Please state your name.
Hello, my name is Edwin Davila. I grew up in Belmont, Cragen. I had a rough transition to high school during my freshman and sophomore year at Noble. I wasn't thinking about college. It was just a dream. My GPA hovered around a 2.0. I earned a lot of detentions. In the summer after my sophomore year, I worked a construction job and realized that I wanted something different. I grew up in a single-parent household. I grew up not knowing my dad. He's been in jail for 21 years in Dixon, Illinois. I wanted something different. To be able to take care of my mom and my brothers, I wanted my own house, my own family, not to live in poverty. I wanted a Lamborghini. Noble pushed me to put in the effort. So I did. Noble surrounded me with support. Teachers put in extra office hours and pushed me in class. I had an advisor for 4 years. I had coaches who cared about me. Junior and senior year, I got A's in my classes. I brought up my ACT to a 24. Noble made sure I had a college counselor, so I had the support to apply to 10 colleges. It worked. I now attend Northern Illinois University, where I am a junior majoring in mechanical engineering, and my GPA is a 3.4. Noble alumni counselors support me on campus. I get texts reminding me to fill out FAFSA. Noble makes sure I am on track. When I graduate, I want to come back to Chicago and design cars. I am what is right with Chicago Public Schools. I am proof what is possible with big dreams and a great education from Noble. I chose NIU in part because my dad is in jail halfway in between here and there. I visit him as I drive to school and back each semester. My dad will be out in 4 years. I will be a college graduate. He never had that opportunity. You have a choice to make. Which future do you want for Chicago? Don't allow budget cuts to steal the dreams that Noble makes possible. Thank you.
Thank you, Mr. Davila. Our next speakers will be speaker number 8, Nelly Cotton, followed by speaker 24, Cecilia Cervantes. We then will have speaker number 9, Stephanie Arias, and speaker number 10, Mike Wesolowski.
Madam Secretary, before yes, the next Mr. speaker, President? The gentleman that just spoke, could you stand up again?
Mr. Davila?
Just stand up. You spoke well on your own achievements, and that said a lot for you as a person. I was particularly moved at what you said about your father and your desire to remain supportive of him. That speaks well of you as a human being. We'll do our part with a lot of people's help in Springfield to do what we can to close the budget gap. But I thought that your words mm-hmm. were very, very, very powerful mm-hmm. and spoke well of you.
Mm-hmm. Yeah.
Thank you. Last call for Nelly Cotton.
Good morning. My name is Nelly Cotton. I'm a parent, a proud parent, of a Curie Metro High School sophomore and an incoming freshman. I have been begging for equity and resources since 2008. I'm tired of begging. Today, instead, I want to proudly let the board know that in spite of the reprehensible two-tiered educational system created, Curie Metro High School is thriving and vibrant with all our students' energy. I want to thank our phenomenal teachers and strong leadership under our new principal, Ms. Allison Tingwall. This year, our first student was accepted at Harvard and our second at Brown. We have a Golden Apple Scholar in the state program. We have nationally recognized Gates Millennium Scholarship recipients, the citywide valedictorian for the business and finance program. 7 business students won first place titles in the citywide Business Professionals of America competition and competed nationally. Highest IB test, IB diploma program pass rate in CPS with a 92% and the highest IB art scores. First place database career programs in CPS. Students have traveled to LA, Kentucky, Boston, Arizona, Italy, France for experiential learning. Sorry. Won 10 medals, bronze, silver, gold at citywide Special Olympics. Choral and orchestra programs received the highest ratings in state competitions. Miss Valerie Zanos and her Guerrilla Art Class partners with the Museum of Contemporary Art again this year. They have had a film called Wake Up exhibited there. Oppenheimer winner Melinda Wilson was named State of Illinois Dance Teacher of the Year. We have 2 Oppenheimer winners in our art department. Illinois 4A state basketball champions, back-to-back city football champions, 9-time consecutive citywide polo champions. Musicality vocal ensemble will be on America's Got Talent this season. 96% of our seniors applied to 3 or more colleges this year. The Condors are college ready. Imagine for a moment the magnificence of our children's future if neighborhood schools
Ms.
were
Cotton,
fully funded.
Thank you for your
These
comments.
Are just highlights. And I would like to add, please, that you guys know you guys are going to get thrown under the bus by ROM. So why can't you just stand up for our kids and do the right thing?
Our next speaker, please. Cecilia Cervantes. Last call. Thank you. Our next speaker, please. Stephanie Arias. Please state your name.
Good afternoon. My name is Stephanie Arias, and I am the Charter Support Manager at INCS, the Illinois Network of Charter Schools. Last month, the charter community pledged to support CPS's efforts to advocate for equal funding for all children. Despite popular misconceptions, charter schools are public schools too. So when the district hurts financially, we hurt too. Today, I am happy to share that several charter schools have organized over 500 parents to join the rally tomorrow in Springfield. We are glad to add our voices to the collective call for equal funding on behalf of all Chicago children. Additionally, this Monday, we launched a campaign in support of Senate Bill 231. We know that it does not close the entire budget gap, but we believe it's an important step for all kids, especially those from the most vulnerable school districts. As of today, 1,238 people have participated in the campaign, sending over 2,200 emails directly to elected officials. Our state is at a pivotal moment in time. We have an opportunity to define the values upon which our community is built, values of fairness, equity, and justice. We implore decision makers in Springfield to put politics aside and focus on what is fair and best for all children. We must send a message to every community that all citizens of Illinois have equal value, and we are committed to their development. Thanks so much for your time.
Thank you.
Thank you, Ms. Arias. Our next speaker, please.
Good morning. My name is Mark Wislowski. It is an honor to be here today. I'm a proud but concerned parent of Ebinger Elementary. We at Ebinger are acutely aware that Chicago Public Schools is facing an enormous budget crisis. Just last night, Ebinger parents and supporters of over 100 strong took part in a community town hall, sending a clear message to our elected officials that we need immediate action now regarding fair funding for Chicago's children. Please know that our parent community has been and will continue to be rallying back this message and won't stop until fair funding is in place. As we prepare to end the school year, we are looking forward to the next. As reported at past board meetings, Ebinger's enrollment numbers continue to climb, and we continue to use our limited resources to deal with these overcrowding solutions within our own school. Sadly, at the end of this year, we will be dismantling a parent-funded 4-year-old computer lab to make room for an additional 7th grade class. We are also spending school-based money to tear down a wall to make space to accommodate our diverse learners. And perhaps most shockingly, the following year, we will be forced to use our cafeteria for a classroom. These are all just band-aids. They will not last long as we continue to grow, and unfortunately have other ramifications as we continue to repurpose rooms. There are concerns about how these changes will impact Ebinger's IB certification next spring. We need help sooner rather than later. We congratulate Door and Bryn and most recently the South Loop area for their recent announcements of their new schools and annexes. As stated by your spokesperson, while the district faces significant financial challenges, we have a responsibility to provide children across the city with the tools they need to obtain a 21st century education.
Thank you, Mr. Wislowski.
Thank you.
Thank you.
Our next speakers, Mr. President, will be speaker number 11, please, Joy Clendenning, followed by the designated speakers for the UNO Charter School Network, speaker number 15, Maria Zavala, and speaker number 16, Guillermina Valdez. And then we will have the designated speakers for the CICS Longwood Group, speaker number 28, Mary Towns, and speaker 33, Tiffany Turner. Can you please state your name?
Yes, thank you. Good morning. My name is Joy Clendenning. I'm a proud Kenwood Bronco parent of a 2014 graduate and two freshmen there. My daughter goes to Whitney Young. All four of my children attended Ray Elementary, where their professional educators prepared them so well. And I'm especially thankful to Kenwood. My son is finished sophomore year at Occidental College in California, where he continues with his merit-based scholarship and is completely prepared both socially and academically for that institution. I am on the Kenwood LSC. I am not speaking for Kenwood today. And I'm a board member and volunteer with Raise Your Hand Action. Wendy basically said everything, but I did want to let you know that this morning we were rallying parents to make calls. We are calling the governor. We are calling our legislators. We are calling the mayor. We are calling our aldermen. And we're calling on you to stand with us in really talking to all of these elected representatives. We believe that we need our politicians to do what we voted them in to do, which is to protect and uphold the public good, which consists of a strong public education system. I was really inspired by hearing from Cynthia Rodriguez when she said that for change, we need unity, strategy, and communication. Because that's really what I'm here today to talk to you about and to say to each of you board members,
We need you to join with us in demanding that our public servants serve the public. And of course, Governor Rauner, of course, our legislators in Springfield, but even though the mayor appointed you, you're here to serve the children of Chicago, and we need you to talk to the mayor, because there are solutions in City Hall, which might be a Band-Aid, but right now we need everything. And we believe it will actually be more convincing to Springfield if we show what we're doing up here in Chicago as well. So we call on you to call the governor, to call Madigan, and to call the mayor.
Thank
you very much for having us speak today.
Thank you, Ms. Clendenning. Our next speaker, please.
Buenas tardes. Mi nombre es María Zavala. Soy la madre orgullosa de estudiantes que asisten a la escuela primaria Sandra Cinderos y a la escuela secundaria Soccer Academy de la red de escuela Charter UCSN. Estoy muy preocupada por la propuesta para recortar los fondos para nuestras escuelas y el impacto de que estos recortes tendrán en el aula. Tales recortes profundos amenazan nuestro derecho a una educación de calidad para nuestros hijos. Año tras año, los padres se ven obligados a luchar para la financiación que garantiza que nuestros hijos reciban la educación de calidad que necesitan y merecen. Reconocemos las dificultades que la situación financiera del distrito tiene los estudiantes, maestros y directores en cada escuela de CPS. No existen soluciones fáciles. Sin embargo, el distrito no puede seguir eliminando recursos financieros a nuestros estudiantes de escuelas públicas charter. Como madre, estoy de acuerdo con el argumento de CPS, porque estudiantes de Chicago representan 20% de la matrícula del estado, y el Chicago ofrece 20% del dinero de impuestos para fondos de la escuela pública. La educación de la escuela pública. Las escuelas de Chicago deben recibir 20% de financiación del Estado para la educación, en lugar del 15% que actualmente recibían. Por la misma razón, nuestros estudiantes de las escuelas charters representan 16% de la matrícula de CPS, pero las escuelas charter reciben significativamente menos fondos. Equidad trabaja de ambas maneras. Las escuelas charter son escuelas públicas también, y creo que CPS debe hacer más para apoyar a nuestras escuelas. Pero en última instancia, estamos todos juntos en esto. Así que mañana me uno a otros padres de UCSN en viajar a Springfield para reunirnos en la manifestación para apoyar el paso exitoso de la legislación, para abordar las desigualdades de financiación frente a CPS. Nuestros hijos no crearon este problema de presupuesto y sus educaciones no deberían estar en riesgo debido a él. Todos nuestros niños merecen algo mejor y todos nuestros niños merecen una financiación.
I'm going to translate at least briefly. My name is María Zavala. I am a proud mother of students attending Sandra Cisneros Elementary and Soccer Academy High School, both from UNO Network Charter Schools. It worries me the proposal of budget cuts and the impact is going to have these budget cuts in the classroom. The cuts threaten our right to a quality education for our children. Year after year, we as parents have to fight to get the funds our children need to get the education they deserve. We recognize the crisis at the district, the financial crisis. There are not easy solutions. However, the district cannot keep eliminating resources from charter schools. As a mother, I agree that Chicago Public Schools should receive more resources from the state, 20% instead of 15%, but charter school students are 16% of CPS enrollment and they receive less funds. Equality works both ways. Charters are also public schools, and I think CPS should do more to support our charter schools. In this fight, we are all together. Tomorrow, we are going to be attending in Springfield, rallying in Springfield with UNO parents. Our children did not create this budget problem. Their education should not be at risk. Our children deserve equal funding. Correct?
Correct. Thank you.
Thank you.
Our next speaker, please.
Buenas tardes a todos. Gracias por su tiempo y por ayudar a nuestros hijos. Yo le pedí previamente que tradujera lo que iba a hablar. Para cortar tiempo, voy a dejar.
I'm grateful that you give me this chance. This is my speech translated into English, so I'm gonna read her words. Okay. My name is Guillermina Valdez. I am a proud mother of a student attending Octavio Paz Elementary from UNO Network. I also have a graduating senior who's going to be attending UIC in the fall. He's attending now DRW College Prep from Noble. I am excited for having the chance of selecting my children's school in Chicago. The education my daughter is receiving is exceptional. All the teachers are committed. They are always available when needed. And for UNO, it's very important that I have voice, an opinion, and an option in the education of my daughter. As a parent, I know what is best for her. But it concerns me, your proposal of budget cuts and the impact in the classroom. Those deep cuts threaten our right to a quality education for our children. We recognize the district problems, the financing problems, the crisis. This reflects on the students, teachers, and principals. But the district cannot keep eliminating resources from charter schools. If our students are 16% of CPS enrollment, why charter schools receive much less funds? We want equality for all our students. Charter schools are public schools too, and you have to do more to support them. Tomorrow, I will be in Springfield to rally with UNO families to fight for equality in funding. Our children deserve something better. Fair fundings, equal funds for their educations, all deserve a choice, right? Mm-hmm. Not only those whose parents are rich now. Is that more or less? Yeah, I think. Yeah, she wants to add also that that school, DRW, is 100% college acceptance this year. And this group, belonging to the senior, is the first graduation class in that school. Nothing else?
As a result. Thank you.
Okay.
Thank you. Thank you for your comments. Our next speaker, please.
Good afternoon, everyone. My name is Tamar Schaefer, and we are here representing CICS Longwood Charter School on 95th. Not only do I have a student at Longwood, I'm also an administrative assistant there, so I know what's going on inside of the building as far as administration goes and as far as a parent as well. I'm also over the parent advocacy at Longwood, and we just want to come and say that with the budget cuts, we're seeing teachers being taken away, and not only that, I know you guys are familiar with Lloyd Bond closing, and their students are coming to Longwood. And so with that, we want to keep as many staff members as possible. We are also going to be losing security guards, and that's unfortunate for us because we want to keep our building as safe as possible. I also have two parents here with me, Miss Tiffany Turner and Miss Mary Towns, and they just want to speak on behalf of their experience at charter schools.
So really quickly, my son is 17 and he's been there since kindergarten. The social workers in the school just followed him the entire way, and that's just, it makes you feel good to know that I'm not a good public speaker, that you that your children are just well taken care of and they've been in a safe place. And that's more of a, he's been there as a family. We all work together. Everyone knows him, and he's just comfortable, stable is the word. It's stability for him. So thank you.
Hi, good morning. My name is Mary Towns, and I have a ninth grader at Longwood Academy. And actually, he's a turnaround student. He came to Longwood in sixth grade, and they have worked with him tremendously because he was having problems from other schools. But right now, he is a turnaround student, and I commend the teachers because I have access to just texting the teachers, calling them whenever I need to. If he say he don't have homework, I can text her and say, do you have homework tonight for him? And she'll text me right back. So I commend the school, but it takes parents to work as well. It takes us to work with our children. So thank you, and I want to welcome you all to come out to Longwood on the board. Just stop by the school and see what we're doing over there.
And also, I just wanted to mention that with the new admin team that we have going on, and our principal, Kenyatta Stark, she came in at the school, and we were at a level 3, and now we're a level 2 plus. So we are moving in the right direction. And like I said, with the new students coming in, it would be a deficit if we lost, you know, those funds to continue to get those students where they need to be academically. And I just want to say thank you again for your time.
Thank you, Ms. Schaefer. Our next speakers, Mr. President, will be speaker number 17, Jose Hernandez, followed by speaker number 18, Arnie Stiber, followed by speaker 19, David Vance, and 20, Rosita Shatunda.
Good morning. My name is Jose Hernandez. I'm a parent of a seventh grade daughter attending Calmeca Academy. I'm also a member of the LSE there. This is a regular Chicago school, and I just wanted to mention a few of the wonderful things that are happening there. This is a dual language school. Our students are graduating fully bilingual. They're also learning Mandarin. We have a list of children on the waiting list for the lottery. They want to attend Calmeca Academy. It's the end of May, and we still have over 100 students participating in many after-school programs. Calmeca Academy opened its doors on September 2010 as a level 3 school. It only took 4 years for it to become a level 1 school. We have many programs. Our mariachi program, the students perform at numerous events, including the U.S. Cellular Field. I'm also on the LSE at Kelly High School. The first thing that I want to tell you about Kelly is that it's a regular Chicago Public Schools, Chicago Public School. I'm on the LSE there, and we voted just last Monday to award a contract to a new principal. We have 100% of our students applying for college and being accepted to college. Also, our fabulous choir sang the national anthem at the U.S. Cellular Field. All of this is on the line if you proceed with the cuts at the school. On another issue, I'm here today to recommend a warning resolution for Efrain Martinez, principal at Orozco Academy, for failing to fulfill his duties. At the beginning of the meeting, we pledge allegiance to the flag of the United States,
Mr. Hernandez,
which stands for liberty
Mr.
and justice
Hernandez,
for all.
Thank you for your comments.
Justice for all. So please
thank
do
you.
Justice for us, our children. Thank you.
Thank you, Mr. Hernandez. Our next speaker, please.
Hi, my name is Arnie Stieber. I'm a grandfather, retired CEO, and an Army infantry veteran of the U.S. war against the people of Vietnam. The Memorial Day Parade is this weekend. This event sparked our Education Not Militarization initiative. In 2013, several Veterans for Peace members attended the Memorial Day Parade, expecting to see a somewhat somber tribute to all those killed in war. We were shocked to see that the vast majority of the parade was youth in military uniforms. We began researching and found that CPS has more youth and military training, over 10,000 of them, than any other school system in the nation. In the fall of 2013, we started attending and speaking at these meetings. We have learned much, and we want to learn more. To better understand the CPS militarization program, Veterans for Peace members met with your junior ROTC staff on May 5th. We gave them our statement of purpose, our position paper on the military model and children, our featured speaker flyer about Rory Fanning, one of our members, and a flyer on our billboard initiative. These are in your packet today. We received information on your program and your curriculum guides. We each presented our views on militarization. Our views were dissimilar, but we agreed that youth need critical thinking skills. We offered your junior ROTC staff the opportunity to exercise students' critical thinking skills by having Veterans for Peace speak at each of your seven of your military academies and all of your junior ROTC and cadet classes. The JROTC staff is considering our offer. We'd like to make a similar offer to this board. We'd like to meet with you as a board, not individually for 15 minutes, but collectively.
Mr. Steibert, thank you for
and have a roundtable
discussion.
Thank
you for your comments
on militarization.
Thank you. Our next speaker, please.
Okay, yes, good morning, board members. My name is David Vance. Bowen has no marquee. We need a lighted marquee at our school. So what happened 3 years ago? What happened? Barbara Bird Bennett had the power to close 50 schools and create a dozen charter schools. And many of those co-sharing charter schools went to Noble. And one of those was Baker. So what happened? They took our marquee, they got our new annex building, they took our marquee off and put Baker on it. They confused the neighborhood. They thought Bowen closed. So it's sad, but very convenient for them. So this marquee is essential. It's not a frill. You should know Bowen has a 100-year history. We are the historic high school of South Chicago. We have our mascot is a Boilermaker. We have those roots from the steel worker era. And we need, that's why this is important. So in conclusion, 1 minute. How do we get the money? And you say there's no money, Mr. Claypool. Well, let's go to Barbara Bird Bennett. She owes restitution for stealing millions of dollars, I'm told. We want a sliver of that restitution to go to Bowen for a marquee. That's what we want. I think it's possible. It's not too much to ask restitution for the harm caused. And maybe your Nicholas Schuler, your inspector general, can look into this. Give us a solution. Give us help. Find a way to do this. Give us a sliver of what she owes. She owes us. And no one should be stealing. And what happened to Bowen should not happen to any high school.
Thank you.
Okay, thank you.
Thank you, Mr. Vance. Our next speaker, please.
Good morning. My name is Rosita Chitunda. I am the co-chair for the South Shore Community Action Council. And first of all, I'd like to start off by acknowledging, I'm here today acknowledging the great work of one of our greatest education and community organizers, Mr. Henry English, who has recently departed, and he was our mentor. We met at Buffy for years, and we just want to honor his legacy. One of the things that Mr. English taught us is to be present in our education communities. So we were present, and yesterday I went out to some of a school, and this is what I want to talk about today, which wasn't originally what I was going to talk about. But as some of our CAC members had decided that being present means to be a part of the local school council, because I don't know, some of you know me, but I think I've done it all. I've been a parent, I've been a teacher, I've been a union organizer, I'm the co-chair of the CAC, and so the only thing I haven't done is BLSC. So I went there with the idea that the LSCs and the CACs would merge. And I had 3 instances of schools that I was involved with in some way. And that was South Shore International, and that's Mann. I live across the street from Mann, and Powell School. One of the problems is the process. At each one of those schools, there were things that were going on with the LSC process that raised the hair. You know, I am going to talk about that later with someone from the LSC, because there are some things that are going on in these schools. We don't even know if Paul had a candidates form. We don't know if parents were notified. I came into the school and I was met with nothing but resistance. Yes, from the LSC.
Thank you for your comments.
Thank you. And just closing, I'd like to close.
Let her close.
Okay. Well, you know what? Go ahead. Okay, I would just like to close. This isn't what I originally came here for, but I will. Hopefully, I'll get a chance to talk to someone privately about the other issue. And please, we will be at Buffy again. And we are not meeting there now because of the transition of Mr. English, but we do invite all of you to come out to the South Shore CAC.
Thank you.
Thank you. Mr. President, our next group of speakers are from Lane Tech, and the designated speakers are speaker number 39, please, Sabah Hussein, followed by speaker 42, Juan Garcia, and then we have speaker number 29, Valerie Magalone, followed by speaker number 30, DeAndre Allen. Please state your name.
Good morning. My name is Sabah Hussein, but you know me as 446-395-70. I'm from the school who's going to be losing $8.5 million in funding if CPS students, if CPS decides to carry out a 39% budget cut citywide. I have been unfortunate enough, along with many CPS students, to see the constant struggle between our teachers and CPS for decent funding of our education. Fewer resources have been offered to our students, and living wages for our teachers continue to shrink. It's time for CPS to right its wrongs. It's time for CPS students to receive the education that they not only need, but rightfully deserve. We deserve to be invested in. We deserve to be equipped with a meaningful education that prioritizes us instead of big money. We need to stop the systematic starvation of public education. Now, I'm not unreasonable, and I am fully aware of the inequality that exists in state educational funding. However, I am reasonable enough to recognize that it's not the fairly recent undoing of Springfield that has caused the current state of turmoil and crisis in Chicago. You cannot use Springfield's mismanagement to cover up your wrongdoings and your inaction over the past couple of years. While we continue to fight for 20, CPS needs to be more realistic and more professional. CPS needs to take matters into its own hands. It's time CPS owns up to its past mistakes and searches for alternative, more sustainable sources of revenue so we can generate more money to support our schools, our teachers, and our students. On behalf of the Chicago Students Union, I demand that you advocate for the reallocation of TIF funds and TIF reform, the passage of the progressive income tax and the LaSalle Street tax as real solutions to the CPS funding problem. Dear unelected school council, do your job and fund our education.
Our next speaker, please. Please state your name.
My name is Juan Garcia. Let me pull this up real quick. Okay, so good morning, ladies and gentlemen. Thank you for letting me talk. Today I decided I'm gonna take a fortunate break from my classes to talk to you about money. Talk about why we should not cut it from the budgets of CPS schools citywide. So, it seems to me that state funding feels as though it's not wise to invest in their future. And by the future, I'm talking about the future leaders of this nation. Your president in 2040 could be in a school somewhere here that's not receiving adequate funding. So that's not good. It seems to me that athletics, after school programs and everything, that are not going to be existing sooner because of 40 staff members in my school that would be not returning next year as a result of this budget cuts will not exist anymore. So it seems as though they do not realize these things are paramount to some schools. Some ask, why sports? These do not help kids excel in ACT or SAT, but I disagree. Now, I'm almost positive that everyone in this room, after a long, hard day of work, needs some closure, whether it be watching your favorite TV show in the afternoon when you get home, watching sports, you know, back riding, going to the gym, whatever it may be. Now imagine these favorite leisure activities suddenly disappearing because whoever offers funding for these activities suddenly does not want to invest in this. I do not think any of you would stand to take that, and as you might expect, not will. Nor will the students of CPS. That's all.
Thank you, Mr. Garcia. Our next speaker, Mr. President, will be speaker number 29, please. Valerie Magalone. Last call.
Hi, my name is Valerie Magallon. I am a student from Hammond Elementary School. We are here because we want to change the name of Columbus Day to Native Americans Day. Kids are still going to have the day off, but we also want kids to learn what Columbus was really in life. Kids think he is a true hero, but he is not. People ask questions like, what did Christopher Columbus explore? The answer is in a book. It says he wanted to explore a new land. Is that true? No. We now know that Columbus killed for the gold. One fact is that Columbus cut off Native Americans' hands, ears, and noses to find gold. Please help by signing the petition we have and to also change the name. We at Hammond School did research and students from classes and parents signed the petition because they agree with us. Different places did the same thing. Some cities already changed the name of Columbus Day. We did a lot of research that we found even more about Columbus. So please change the name.
Well, my name is Omar Chavez from Hammond Elementary School, and me and my colleague want also to change Columbus Day. Christopher Columbus, you think is a good man, but you need to do extra research to know what he really is. We found most of our information from theoatmeal.com. He is the one that made us start this project because our teacher saw it and he wanted to show us. I know most people in the future, they did bad things, but this was in the beginning of time. Then Columbus did not get any consequences from killing all these people. All they wanted was the gold and nothing happened. And he took more people as slaves and wanted to use them for little things.
Mm-hmm. What?
Okay, I'm done.
Thank you. As we come to close to closure, it is very, very difficult. Let the young kids stay for a moment. It is very difficult to stand in front of an audience and speak publicly, and to do it at such a young age speaks well of you. You did a great job, both of you. Thank you.
Thank you, Mr. President. Our next call, is DeAndre Allen. Last call. Moving on to the next speaker, please. Speaker 31, Francis Newman, followed by Speaker 35, Carol Collins Ayanala, Speaker 36, Anna Jones, and 37, Cassandra Cresswell. Speaker 31, please. Francis Newman, last call. Moving on to the next speaker, Speaker 35, Carol Collins, please.
Good afternoon, Board of Education.
and leadership of Chicago Public Schools. I'm Dr. Carol Collins Ayanlaja. Next to me, I have Ms. Janet Pass of the Grassroots Coalition of Chicago and members of her team. I am the consultant superintendent for Prologue Schools Incorporated. We received on last week letters indicating that Witte Mandela Intergenerational High School, along with Prologue Early College School, contracts are being recommended for non-renewal by the Office of Innovation and Incubation. And we ask that the Board of Education consider that request as a non-valid request on behalf of the Prologue Network. The Prologue Network is a network that is over 40 years old, providing education to people in the community. African American people like those next to me, young people partnering with the community in the effort to ensure that there are better results in the community. It is a top provider of alternative education in the African American community. Why not now? We do respect the Office of Innovation and Incubation with their vetted comprehensive process of looking at school progress. It cites financial instability along with concerns with academics is the reason why the schools are recommended not to be renewed. We acknowledge that there needs to be improvement, and we respect the efforts of the office, but what we do not believe is that this is the time, nor the place, or the climate in the city of Chicago to recommend closure of schools that some of the most left-behind students in this city attend. Those same black boys that we see standing on the corner are the boys that walk our halls every day by choice. These students come to this school. Many of these students are empowered by the school. The themes are social justice, humanism, cultural understanding, Afrocentric ideologies, self-collective efficacy, and agency. All these things are the things that make it important for the African American community in the city of Chicago to engage in and be part of. We are developing youth to do that. As a new consultant superintendent to the organization, I ask the board to please consider our program for restructuring. We have created a program. We are available to share that program with you. We want to work in partnership with you and a community agency that is well established and is providing alternative education to help lead us in this restructuring effort. With all due respect, we ask that you not hastily decide to close these schools and you work in collaboration with us. Thank you.
Thank you, Ms. Collins. Our next speaker, please. Please state your name.
Hi, my name is Anna Jones. I'm a Bronzeville parent. I'm a mother of four children. I have one daughter who still attends public school. My three younger children, I had to take them out of Mollison Elementary School last fall due to the inhumane conditions of the school and the lack of investment in the school, the overcrowdedness in the schools, the lack of sufficient libraries in the school, lack of services granted to our children with disabilities in the schools. Everything in the school, based on the policies that are demanded and enforced by the board, has affected our children, has affected my family, has affected my community. I think we all can agree that education is the key to success. Well, my children's success has been compromised. Therefore, I have every right to feel like their success will be compromised due to the lack of education that has been granted and given to my children. I'm not going to play the charades about the budget. We are in the richest country in the world. There's no excuse for a poor education for our children. It's a fact that there's no written record of equity for African American people. So there's no plan to educate our children. So the fact that it was on purpose that our children's education has been sabotaged is an insult. And if you people that are standing before me cannot do anything to Springfield or anything on behalf of our children's education, then you need to not be sitting before us. If there's nothing that you can do to help us, we don't need people to stand in front of us, to sit in front of us with nice comments and pretty fancy suits on and smile on your face, because our children are dying in the streets. Our educators are being displaced. Our schools and everything is being broken. And these are facts that back in the days in the 60s or Brown versus Board of Education, these things are coming to us again. History is repeating itself all over again. Our communities have been
impoverished. Thank you, Ms. Jones.
And it's due to the lack of investing in our children's school, and we are fed up with it, and we are not going to be obedient by laws that do not serve us. Thank you.
Our next speaker, please.
So the district is in dire financial straits. There'll be $24 million on hand after the June 30th if there's no legislative progress. You're proposing drastic cuts to every classroom in the city, and yet you, the Board of Ed, and CEO Claypool continue to refuse to make some basic, sensible, evidence-based policy changes that could save the district millions of dollars. First, the promotion policy. Another school year has gone by, and the CPS promotion and retention policy remains unchanged. Retention is incredibly damaging. A study more than a decade ago by the Chicago Consortium on School Research, which I told you about in January, showed that retention increases a child's chance of dropping out by 26%. Retention is also incredibly expensive. The full cost of education for an additional year for every one of the thousands of children who are held back. Although CPS supposedly has not been counting how many kids are retained each year, so maybe you want to check on that. Parents who met with the Chief Officer of Teaching and Learning, Annette Gurley, this month were told that the promotion policy could not be changed right now because there's long-term uncertainty about which tests would be used as district-wide assessments. This doesn't make any sense. Retention should be discontinued altogether, not attached to yet another standardized test, and it should be replaced with a system of supports. In the current financial climate, it is beyond crazy to continue a policy that is both damaging, racially discriminatory, and expensive. End retention. Second, standardized testing for K through 2. On the agenda today is another $3.5 million for standardized testing for kindergarten through second grade from NWEA and Amplify. Standardized testing is neither valid nor reliable in early childhood, and in fact, the map for primary grades test was so terrible, you announced that it was being eliminated 3 years ago in a press release saying it was due to concerns raised by teachers, parents, and principals during focus groups and online survey responses about the additional time spent on computer-based assessments by our younger students at the expense of having direct interaction with their teachers. Well, since we measure everything by how many teachers, that would be about 35 teachers that you could give to kindergarten kids instead of doing these horrible tests again.
Ms. Criswell,
this will be added to the more than $80 million spent on standardized testing companies since 2013 and the $70 million spent on software.
Thank you, Ms. Criswell.
Cassandra.
Who really needs this money? Do the kindergarten kids need this money?
No. Let her stay there a second. Sure. Let me ask you a question. You've done this. I've been on the board about a year, and you are passionate about this over-testing. We have gone back, the trustees have gone back to Dr. Jackson's team and to look at what's happened with our testing and how it's evolved. They've done continual amounts of work. Is there any amount of testing that you would say would be reasonable?
Look, you have to do some because the federal government mandates it, right? And you have to do that. That K through 2 testing is not mandated by the federal government. It's not mandated by the state. It's not actually even used in the district high stakes stuff.
Okay.
Why are you testing those little kids? It's pointless. It's terrible.
I hear you.
And it's not happening in schools like the Chicago Lab School. It's not happening at the Chicago Waldorf School. Okay? That's not okay to do that,
Sandra,
to kids just because they're in public school.
How many hours do you think happen, hours of testing occur in the K to 2?
I put a chart together. There's really anywhere from, like, in preschool, there's basically 8 administrations of standardized tests, and it goes up from there. So it's around 8 or 12 typically.
Hours
there's
a
kids,
year?
I don't know. That's just tests, so it depends how long that takes. Also, a lot of it is one-on-one testing. So if a teacher has to do one-on-one testing with, say, 25 or 35 kids in her class, you know, those other kids aren't doing anything during that time. They're doing, you know, their own thing or centers, but that's a lot of time.
Okay,
there was so much one-on-one testing. That was 5 years ago when my child was a kindergartner, that her teacher was happy that she could read because she would read to the class while the teacher finished up the one-on-one testing. So that gives you an idea of how much one-on-one testing is happening. It's a lot.
Hang in there a second. I want to ask Dr. Jackson. So we just went through a briefing. We've been through multiple ones, some of it driven by your questions because you come here focused on different issues, but testing has been one of them. Maybe give her just a second to talk about the stuff she took us through in this last month about their assessment and some of their conclusions, and then provide her a comment when she's done.
All
All right. Well, I think she was accurate in the amount of assessments that are administered, and also accurate in the fact that they're administered one-on-one. The teacher isn't always the person administering the test. Sometimes we have subs and other people who come in. I think the point that Mr. Furlong is asking us to raise is just around the percent of time overall that students spend on testing, which may be smaller than what people think. I would also add, though, that it is accurate that there's been more testing than it was in the past, and that there are also some issues just around the extended testing climate in school. So while different grades may only take a test for a certain period of time, there is, you know, for the spring season, kids are testing throughout the year at various grade levels. So that's why the district has made a commitment around reducing testing altogether and reducing testing except for those things that are mandatory. I will say at the primary age that the testing is significant because we have to track our student progress. I think you brought up a point around the promotion policy, and as you may know, majority of our students who are retained at third grade, and we see those numbers decrease over time. So assessing students ahead of time, we believe, or are part of our strategy, is that we will see fewer students who need to be retained at third grade because we have valid data and we can intervene sooner. That's the strategy, and that's the way we've been approaching this.
3 years ago, CPS announced that they were reducing testing significantly. If you look at what was reduced, that was pretty much not true. And you should really look at those numbers. The way it was presented was very deceptive. And in fact, if anything, testing increased. There was a lot of emphasis in that about decreasing it in K through 2. It did not decrease in K through 2. And I don't know when that's going to happen. Mm-hmm. So, you've been hearing me for the last year. I've been coming for several years talking about this. You know, I pulled my own children out of CPS because of what K through 2 is like in CPS. And it's just not acceptable. No one should have to drive across town and pay thousands of dollars to do something that CPS could do for free, i.e. stop testing small children.
Mm-hmm. Mm-hmm. Let me ask just one other question, and then we'll do our follow-up separately and then communicate with you. So the information I looked at for K to 2, it had the testing in like the 4.5 to 6 hours total mm-hmm. per year. You believe that number is a multiple of that?
I think that's probably not. That sounds like a real undercounting. If you're counting the teacher hours spent, almost no schools have money for subs to take the classroom while a teacher is testing. Like, that just doesn't happen. I can't imagine that happening anywhere. So, no, that's an undercounting.
Okay, we'll look into it.
I mean, so let's put a comparison here. If you go to the lab school, you take standardized tests around, I think, 4 times from K through 12. You take that in preschool in CPS, in 1 year of preschool, double that. So mm-hmm. put that in perspective. It's really not necessary. And if it was necessary, the rich parents sending their kids to private school would be demanding it, and they aren't. So keep that in mind.
Thanks.
Our next speaker will be speaker number 38, Maya Hernandez, followed by speaker number 40, Estela Corona. We then have speaker 41, Jeffrey Bolkowitz, and speaker 45, George Schmidt. Speaker 38, please, Maya Hernandez. Last call. Speaker 40, Estela Corona, last call. Our next speaker, please. Please state your name. Sir.
I'm sorry. My name is Jeff Berkowitz. I host and produce a TV show called Public Affairs, which airs throughout the city of Chicago every Monday night at 8:30 p.m. and midnight on Channel 21. I think Ms. Jones, one of the speakers just before, mentioned it sort of in passing. Kids are dying out there. Kids are dying. I think she got that right. And one of the reasons why they're dying out there is because kids aren't learning how to read. Robin Staines on my program a few years ago said that only 25% or so of the black and Hispanic kids in CPS in fourth grade read at grade level, 75% don't. Now, you may dispute that. Maybe Ms. Staines will reassess that. I think you ought to be discussing that. I think you ought to be discussing that quarterly. If you think that's right, what are you doing about it? If you think it's wrong, persuade me and others that it is. It's key. As Barack Obama, our president, said, the fierce urgency of now, as Dr. Martin Luther King said, the fierce urgency is now. If you can teach kids how to read, they won't join gangs as much, they won't shoot each other, they won't be dying as much. On finances, you know, we've had a $6 billion budget in CPS, or 400,000 kids or so for the last 4 or 5 years with the revenue going up and down. That's about 15,000 per kid per year. You know, you can run to Springfield all you like, you can talk 2020 all you like. You know, it's time to start planning. You may get $200 million, you may get three. Mr. Claypool, you may get 500, but you may get zip. So start thinking right now. You ought to be, as a board, you ought to be making plans for how many teachers, obviously your costs are in the teachers, are the principals, and so forth. Look, I asked Mr. Claypool to be on my show. He committed to be here on May 10th to discuss these and other issues. Half hour video interview in the conference room. We are coming to him. He said the night before, they called me, the communications people, and said, can't be there,
but Mr. Berkowitz,
a 15-minute phone interview. It's time for him to be there.
Thank you for your comments.
Mr. Clark, we invite you.
Thank you.
Any of you board members, just challenge these issues. That's all we're saying.
Thank you.
Thank you.
Our next speaker, please.
I don't prepare to say good morning because these things usually go into the afternoon. Good afternoon. Mm-hmm. I've been covering, my name is George Schmidt and I'm the editor of Substance. I've been covering the Board of Education now going into our 42nd year, and I dare say I didn't expect to be celebrating my 70th birthday in a few months by continuing to come to these meetings and remind you of the fantasies versus the facts. I won't talk about the scandal of early childhood testing because Cassie Cresswell did a better job of that than I could. However, I will talk to you about the ridiculousness of your continued privatization through Aramark and Sodexo Magic, both of which are on the agenda today for a total of, if my math is correct, $340 million. $340 million to privatize services which shouldn't have been privatized in the first place, to do unaccountable activities which have been proven, as our colleague said earlier, Annette Rizzo, to be a failure. And you're going to vote on two board reports today to add $260 million on Sodexo, on Aramark, excuse me, and $80 million on Sodexo. That's ridiculous, and yet you will do it, I am confident, because you have rubber-stamped every one of these privatization schemes since I started watching this juggernaut of privatization about 20 years ago when the Amendatory Act was passed. Yes, I am outraged. I have two children in the public schools, both of whom opt out of these ridiculous tests, and one now, a successful engineer in Berkeley and the Bay Area in California, who graduated in 2007 from Whitney Young. There is no excuse for what you're doing. You're abusing our children, and you should, in fact, stop this. If you do nothing today but vote down those Aramark and Sodexo contracts, I will be glad to report my cheers. But as of now, I think you're all hypocrites, and I think you're a continuation of the hypocrisy we've denounced
for years. Mr. Schmidt, thank you for your comments.
You're welcome.
Our next speaker, Mr. President, will be speaker number 46, Janet Meegan, followed by speaker 47, Cameron Miller, and the last speaker, Brandon Helwig.
My name is Janet Meegan. I have a fifth grade student and pre-K student at Carl von Linné Elementary School, and I sit on the local school council. I want you to know that we have fantastic staff at Linné. Even though most of our after-school programming was cut, our teachers still have after-school tutoring and continue sports programming on their own time. Despite cuts to Linné in the past, we have managed to fundraise and scrimp and save and continue to offer dance, music, art, and science in a real science lab. We have state-of-the-art technology and a dual language program that I intended to enroll my pre-K student in next year. We have a culinary program where the children use fresh ingredients from our learning garden to create fantastic food while learning about health and nutrition. We have maintained a level plus one school for 3 years. It's a great school. We used to have boys and girls soccer and basketball, reading and math interventionists, school nurse, school musical, chorus, student council, chess club, geography club, school newspaper, and paraprofessionals to help with our special education children. All gone now. I attended a budget meeting last night, as many parents are doing all over the city, where I learned our cut at Lanay will be over $1 million. I learned everything that we managed to save will be gone, and we will lose an additional 8 teaching positions. Class size will start at 44. We will have split classrooms, cut our dual language program, ESP support, part-time library position, subsidies for field trips, professional development for our staff and materials for our science program, and we will either have to cut art or music. We will no longer have both as promised by ROM. There's nothing left after that. I've done my part. I've been to Springfield 3 times this year asking for fair funding. I pay my taxes. I volunteer at my children's school, including a ridiculous amount of fundraising over the years. I donate supplies monthly. I am here to ask you to do your part.
Ms. Megan.
My children have done enough to balance your budget. This budget, this board has made terrible financial mistakes and wasted millions that surely would have come in handy now. I certainly think more can be done, and I urge you to dig deep and do the right thing by every child in Chicago Public Schools.
Our next speaker, please, Cameron Miller. Last call. The next speaker, Brandon Helwig. Last call. Mr. President, that concludes public participation.
Thank you very much. Board members, are there any questions you have regarding the comments made during public participation?
President Clark, I'd like to make a few comments.
Of course.
And I think the students from Lane Tech, having spoken about budget cuts and several of the other anecdotes shared today about what the consequences will be, I think many of those sentiments and opinions mirror that of the many CPS students, and they feel the same way and are in the same positions as they are and facing all these cuts and lack of opportunities. So it's all across the board that these students agree on the consequences and sentiments. And also, I think, having spoken with many students, they also agree that renaming Columbus Day, they are in support of renaming Columbus Day, as expressed and supported by our 2 students, I think, that are gone now. But students are in support of renaming Columbus Day. And also, as far as lead testing goes, I think it'd also be a really great idea to perhaps look at schools that are within the boundaries of factories and just kind of maybe test their water or their land as well, because I know that I think Perez Elementary specifically was in the news a few years back about being within the boundary of a metal melting company. Is it Fisk or Kramer? I'm not so sure, but I just want to make sure that their dirt is and land is being tested as well, because I know that the kids go out there every day and they play in the ground and they have a garden there. So that's another source of exposure to lead. So I think if they could look into that, that would be it'd be great. And then also, again, CPS, everyone is encouraging students, families, and parents to go and lobby in Springfield. But I think it'd also be a really great opportunity if CPS were to provide the buses or to provide the resources to allow those families and students to go. It is quite a lengthy trip, and so I think it'd be a great idea if we could just have one day where you can make buses available at several schools for students to meet up and just bus them out so we can all lobby together for equal funding.
Cynthia, thanks to you so much for your suggestion. As always, they're very thoughtful. You know, it's sort of interesting, those of you that have sat through the entire meeting, I guess those of you who are still sitting here, you get a range of views with respect to what the Board of Education can do. Those views vary from very little to nothing to omnipotent. Neither extremes are obviously correct. Incidentally, with respect to Columbus Day, I believe that's a national holiday, and I believe that would have to be addressed outside of the city and state, Washington, D.C. It's an interesting perspective, and I applaud the research that those two young people had done, I'm sure along with others. I don't know if all the facts that's represented are completely consistent, but I think that it is, it's like so many things, history is written by the people who do well, and the people that don't do so well don't get a chance to write. So, who knows? The board will continue to do its work as well as it can. The public participation, while sometimes contentious and frankly difficult to hear, is something that we're here to hear and then try to respond as best we can. As you might have noted, several of us will from time to time interrupt or at least question what a presenter is bringing to us because, frankly, not only do we care, we are trying our best to exercise fair and unbiased judgment, and we try to get as much information as we can. Frankly, when we do something that people like, we generally are applauded. When we don't, we're not necessarily applauded, but we will continue to exercise the best judgment we can. And with that, if there are no other questions or comments,
I just want to make one comment. Yes, Dr. Ives. I agree with Mark. We need to further look into testing. I definitely agree with the young lady, and it didn't come up under this administration. We were supposed to be looking at it a long time ago. There's no research available that supports testing kids at that age group. There's none. And they are over-tested, and the one-on-one testing that is done normally takes an adult from the classroom, whether it's a teacher or an assistant. I couldn't believe it, for hours at a time. And like I said, there is no research shown that will show you that that kind of testing is effective for little kids.
Thank you very much, Dr. Hines. Seeing no other questions or comments from public participation, I believe that we will now move into closed session. I need a motion, and I believe Dr. Hines, you have a motion.
I move for the passage of motion number 16-0525-M01 and the commencement of a closed session to consider the subject specified in the motion.
I second the motion.
Thank you. I'll proceed with a roll call. Member Furlong?
Yes.
Member Jordan Turner?
Yes.
Vice President Guzman?
Yes.
Member Dr. Hines?
Yes.
Member Father Garanzini?
Yes.
And President Clark?
Yes.
6 ayes, 0 nays.
We will go into closed session. We're going to reconvene the Board of Education meeting. Madam Secretary, please proceed with the agenda.
Thank you, Mr. President, and I will start with items from closed session, and I will begin with continued and one amended council retentions. These items do require a vote, and they are first report, the law firm Neal and Leroy LLC for continued services, Hill Law Offices for continued services, and I will proceed with the one amended council retention, amend board report 160224AR2, authorized continued retention of the law firm Brothers and Thompson. Mr. President, these items do require a vote.
Is there a motion?
So moved.
Is there a second?
I second the motion.
I'll proceed with a roll call. Member Furlong?
Yes.
Member Jordan Turner?
Yes.
Vice President Guzman?
Yes.
Member Dr. Hines?
Yes.
Member Father Garanzini?
Yes.
And President Clark?
Yes.
6 ayes, 0 nays. Mr. President, I will continue with settlements and awards. These items do require a vote. The first report is approved settlement of Cormany Copen grievance. Second report, property tax appeal refund. Authorized settlement for NOPHB Building LLC regarding its property for tax years 2009 to 2011. And the third report, property tax appeal refund. Authorized settlement of One Congress Center regarding its property for tax year 2009 to 2011. Mr. President, these items do require a vote.
If there are no objections from my fellow board members, please apply the last favorable roll call vote.
Thank you, Mr. President. I will continue with warning resolutions from the Chief Executive Officer. These items do require a vote, and they are King Hall, Contract Principal, O'Toole Elementary School, Gerald Morrow, Contract Principal, Dunbar Vocational Career Academy, David Kempkin, Social Worker Citywide. Mr. President, these items do require a vote.
If there are no objections from my fellow board members, please apply the last favorable roll call vote.
Thank you, Mr. President. I'll continue with items from the board, and these items do require a vote, and they are: first report, resolution by the Board of Education of the City of Chicago regarding the dismissal of Mary Weaver, contract principal assigned to Jonathan Y. Scammon Elementary School. The second report is the resolution approving the Chief Executive Officer's recommendation to dismiss educational support personnel. And the third report is the resolution approving the Chief Executive Officer's recommendation to dismiss probationary appointed teachers. And for the record, Mr. President, I would like to note that on May 20th, 2016, the board members and the office of the board received the CEO's recommendation to dismiss probationary appointed teachers pursuant to Board Rule 4-1105 ILCS 5/34-84. His recommendation included the names of the teachers affected and the reasons, and he also noted that the teachers affected will be notified of their dismissal after adoption of the resolution. We then have the fourth report, resolution authorizing the honorable termination of regularly certified and appointed teachers. And Mr. President, these items do require a vote.
If there are no objections from my fellow board members, please apply the last favorable roll call vote.
Thank you, Mr. President. And I believe Vice President Guzman has a motion, please.
I move that the board adopt the minutes of the closed session meeting of April 27, 2016, pursuant to Section 2.06 of the Open Meetings Act. Board members reviewed these minutes and determined that the need for confidentiality exists. Therefore, the minutes of the closed session meeting held on April 27, 2016 shall be maintained as confidential and not available for public inspection.
I second the motion.
Thank you.
Thank you. I'll proceed with a roll call. Member Furlong?
Yes.
Member Jordan Turner?
Yes.
Vice President Guzman?
Yes.
Member Dr. Hines?
Yes.
Member Feather Garanzini?
Yes.
President Clark?
Yes.
6-5-0 nays. And I believe Member Furlong has a motion, please.
I move that the record of proceedings of the regular board meeting of April 27, 2016, prepared by the board secretary, be approved, and that such records of proceedings be posted on the Chicago Board of Education website in accordance with Section 2.06B of the Open Meetings Act.
Is there a second?
I second the motion.
Thank you. I'll proceed with a roll call. Member Furlong?
Yes.
Member Jordan Turner?
Yes.
Vice President Guzman?
Yes.
Member Dr. Hines?
Yes.
Member Father Garanzini?
Yes.
President Clark?
Yes.
6-0 nays. Mr. President, I'll continue with one real estate item, and this item does require a vote. Resolution designating for acquisition real property for the construction of a new school to relieve overcrowding. And Mr. President, this item does require a vote.
If there are no objections from my fellow board members, please apply the last favorable roll call vote.
Thank you, Mr. President, and I will now continue with the items on the public agenda and only read the board report numbers since the titles and board reports appeared on the public agenda. I will begin with one resolution that does not require a vote. It's RS1, and Mr. President, this item just needs to be accepted by the board.
Please mark received and filed.
Thank you, Mr. President. I will now continue with additional items on the public agenda that do require a vote, and they are RS2, 3, 4, and 5. We then have the policies, PO1, 2, and 3. Mr. President, these items do require a vote.
If there are no objections from my fellow board members, please apply the last favorable roll call vote.
Thank you, Mr. President. I will now continue with the communications. These items do not require a vote. CO1 is regarding the location of the board meeting of June 22nd, 2016. And it reads, this is to advise that the regular meeting of the Board of Education scheduled for Wednesday, June 22nd, 2016 will be held at the CPS Loop Office, 42 West Madison Street, Garden Level Boardroom. The board meeting will begin at 10:30. Public participation guidelines are available on www.cpsboe.org or by calling the board office at 773-553-1600. For the June 22nd, 2016 board meeting, advance registration to speak and observe will be available beginning Monday, June 20th at 10:30 a.m. and will close on Tuesday, June 21st at 5 p.m. or until all slots are filled. And you could advance register during the registration period by the following methods: online, by phone, or in person. And the public participation segment of the meeting will begin as indicated in the meeting agenda and proceed for no more than the 60 registered speakers. CO2 is the communication regarding the 2016-2017 schedule of regular board meetings for the Board of Education, and it reads, to the members of the Board of Education, I am hereby submitting the 2016-2017 schedule of regular board meetings. The board meetings will be held on the fourth Wednesday of each month unless otherwise indicated. The board meetings will be held at the CPS Loop Office, 42 West Madison Street, Garden Level Boardroom, and will begin at 10:30 until further notice. Advanced registration for public participation will open the Monday preceding the board meeting at 10:30 and close on Tuesday at 5 p.m. or until all slots are filled and advanced registration is available for speakers and observers. And you can advance register via the online, phone, or in person. The public participation segment of the meeting will begin as indicated on the meeting agenda and proceed for no more than the 60 registered speakers. Further, let the official record reflect that the 2016-27 planning calendar has been prepared in accordance with the Illinois Open Meetings Act and will be available for public distribution. And we will also be posting this information on our website. Mr. President, I'll now continue with additional items on the public agenda that do require a vote, and they are EX 1 and 2. And for the record, I would like to note an abstention for Board Member Furlong on EX 2. We then have EX 3, 4, moving on to OP 1, 2, and 3. We then have PR 1 and 2. And for the record, I would like to note an abstention for President Clark on PR 2. Moving on to PR 3, 4, 5, 6, 7, 8, 9, 10, 11, 12, 13, 14, 15, 16. And Mr. President, these items do require a vote.
If there are no objections from my fellow board members, please apply the last favorable roll call vote with the noted abstentions.
Thank you, Mr. President. I will continue with additional items that do not require a vote, and they are EX 5, 6, and AR 1. Mr. President, these items just need to be accepted by the board.
Please mark received and filed.
Thank you, Mr. President, and there are no further items on the public agenda.
Is there a motion to adjourn?
So moved.
Is there a second?
All in favor?
All in favor.
Aye.
Aye.
We are adjourned. Thank you.